Thank you. in life. Ayo! How we doing?
Mr. Ayo.
Yeah. daylight come and we want to go home.
Yeah, because it's been Halloween and people are dead.
As is a standard Halloween. Mm. How are we doing, peoples? What do you know? What's going on? I didn't even have time to tell Duncan that what I had just happened, because I've just been getting ready. I had a client email me and kind of go like, oh, so we need these videos you're doing for our website tonight because our web developer's moving house tomorrow. And that was at about 20 past six. And I was like, right. Oh, shit, well, I'm not letting them down. Like, no way. But also, I'm dressed as Dr. Loomis and I'm about to do a stream. So I think I got it off. And then I was dashing about, just like, oh, my giddy arsehole.
Yeah.
So you go. I'm very warm. The Dr. Loomis costume is very warm. And that's my piece. How are you?
I'm good. I'm good. Yeah, I feel warm. And I'm just wearing butter shirt and Oxford. Yes, I'm good. I'm good. I'm insanely busy, as are you, which is lovely. So much work going on. So much baby stuff going on, so much things happening. Got a new phone.
Oh, that happened, did it?
Yeah, that happened, yeah. Yeah, thanks, Angelo.
Oh, jolly good. Oh, jolly good. That's a fucking quick turnaround. You're only talking about that a few days ago.
He literally, I ordered it through him, and he's like, oh, that'll be with you tomorrow. And I was like, what? Because I also ordered my laptop through him, and that took weeks.
Like, oh man, Angelo Canale, unsung hero of Val Verde.
Yeah, fellow.
Sorting with Apple products all the time.
Yeah, fellow horologist. Fan of watches. Yes, yes, yes.
Good times. Oh, yeah. I've just got my shitty like Fitbit with its Velcro elastic strap.
Nice.
You can buy the kind of metallic ones, but my issue with watches is that I don't like. I just found the remains of a spider on Ivan's old coat. That seems Halloween appropriate. Oy vey. Spooky goblins. I just find them really uncomfortable to wear. I could get a metal strap, but I ended up with the little elastic one like a child.
Well, you've got to. You've got to be specific now. For me, I can't go out without one. And I tried one on a while ago that was titanium, and it just was so light, I couldn't get towards it. It was also $8,000, so I thought I won't be buying that.
That's enough to. It would appear someone's just said there's an error on Twitter, so I just have to go deal with that.
Oh, okay, quick. No problem.
Wow, $8,000. That's that's a sort of.
That was the other turn off.
Yeah, I would imagine so. Yeah. I would imagine so.
Spending $8,000 on a watch. I just.
No, well, it's a time and a place, I suppose. I mean, it's the same with me in kind of filmy gear. I made this, so I've done some kind of Venetian style chiaroscuro lighting behind me.
It's beautiful.
And today Ellie sent me some beer and some other things in the post.
Aww.
And it was very, very sweet. And because I had a bit of a rough time this week, and she knew about it, she sent me some stuff. Yeah. And then like a cat or a child who you buy an expensive gift for and then they play with the box, I got my scissors and my sellotape and I made the kind of, it's called a cookie to like push the light through. Nice. And I made a kind of Venetian blind cookie out of the box of the thing she got me, which has gone very well. And then I did a video, if you're a patron, there's a video about how I did tonight's lighting design. I've been a bit extra tonight. It does not look like a Halloween movie, but on the other hand, fuck it, I'm wearing a big coat.
And he's drinking beer called Hell.
Spooky beer.
Spooky beer. I'm drinking.
Vincent Price voice always makes me happy.
Some Glenlivet tonight. By the way, I always seem to open a bottle on air, and it's not because I drink an entire bottle in a week. I do have others. This is all from Gentleman's Corner, you see, because it's where I keep my finery in the corner, which is basically just because things stack up. So I have like aftershave and
you have kind of slipped that by me. It's only you saying to me now, I don't open a whiskey every week, because now you've mentioned it, I'm kind of like, yeah, you always reach over and sort of go like, well, this week I'm going to...
Yeah, I know.
Take you into this one.
Yes, we're on the end of it.
Gentleman's Corner, of course.
Yes. I always wanted one of those drinks trolleys, but then the problem is you've got this trolley full of booze that's like looking at you. But they, and that's what they were meant for, because like back in the 60s, you know, if you've ever seen Mad Men...
Well, like, it's that kind of liquid lunch whiskey thing, isn't it?
Yeah. Not good.
Okay, there is some wrongness on Twitter, I've been told.
In what sense? So,
It says that it's on Saturday, but it is not. It's now. Ah. So I'm going to go delete it.
Balls.
Which means I have to. This is the thing. I said, like, hey, you know what? I'm not doing Twitter at the moment. I come off Twitter for a little bit.
Yeah.
And then I had to go straight back on that evening and go, oh, we've got a video out.
Carl said it's on Facebook as well.
Oh, fuck. Okay, then.
Great. Well, that's what we like.
Shit happens. Shit happens. Yes. Shit happens. I think we've still got plenty of folk in by the look of things, so not to worry. 79 and building. We've got only one on Twitch tonight. But I think when you multi-stream on Twitch, people are kind of like, well, I might as well be on YouTube. So I'm multitasking and sweating.
Rob Myers says, Duncan, you need the false globe to hold your booze. How right you are, sir. How right you are. Nothing.
I do love those globes. One of my friends had the globo booze, and I do love a good globo booze. It sounds like a company that sells booze globally, but it's not. It's a globe of booze.
Globe booze concern.
So what's happened? I've deleted the tweet. This is it Saturday, but because we're on Periscope and it does at least serve this purpose, the Periscope link has now gone to our Twitter profile. So I'm just going to, sorry, it's not very interesting, content. So we hope you enjoyed our Halloween video. We had loads of fun making it 2 years ago.
Yeah, when I was still in my early 30s.
I didn't even think of it. Don't say things like that. I'm normally the one that says the sad things about age. Yes, no, I'll just delete that. And I can edit that because it's Facebook. Yeah, it's. I just can't multitask because I'm merely a man. Mm-hmm. Very proud of that. I was gonna do. I'm gonna do a review of Joel Schumacher's film DC Cab soon. Because I kind of watched it after he died, and then kind of went, "Wow, this is secretly really amazing." And then I wrote most of a review. Then I got bored. And then I finished it this week because, you know, the Night of the Living Dead thing went over quite well. So I was like, "Yeah, fuck it, let's do more like that." Yeah,
fair enough. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, it's stuff that I need to get, like we've talked about before, I need to get my camera situation sorted so I can film stuff. I mean, I think my phone actually should take pretty decent camera rolls, pretty decent video, but obviously it's not as nice as when you've got a decent lens and all that stuff. So
yeah, I think we should have sort something. Rob Myers asked me, Myers, the man with the appropriate surname tonight, are you on the DSLR? This week I am, Rob, I'm on the DSLR, which is why I can't turn the autofocus off, because I don't have Mr. Tick alarms, so the autofocus is on, so you just have to sit still for 2 hours or 3 hours more.
Apparently I'm quiet.
Oh, okay, just all right, turn it up again. I made Duncan turn his mic down before we started.
Turn it up a bit. How's that? Any better? Is it a bit louder? I'll try and get closer.
I'm sure we'll hear soon enough. Mm-hmm. We'll hear soon enough. Yes. Right. Okay, good. I think I've sorted our social media situation. Okay. So, we gave a choice between Halloween, because we think we're funny, and we're still laughing about it. I thought that was a great poll. So if you're not on Patreon, you had a choice between Halloween. And then I've been going around going like, I hope Halloween wins. Because, you know, I just have no imagination.
We did think about not putting the associated years with it and just literally putting Halloween three times and then basically choosing which one we wanted, but then that's not what you pay for, is it? So
have you seen the Rob Zombie one, the remake? Because I haven't personally.
I didn't think I had, but you know what? I might have seen a bit of it because it's got Malcolm McDowell in it, isn't it? It's Dr. Loomis.
Yes.
So I'm sure I have seen a bit of it, but not, I don't really remember it.
My recollection at the time of that was that the first one, people were kind of like, hey, that's okay. And then people really, really hated the second one.
Mm.
But now it seems from asking around, people are kind of like, oh, no, that both of them are no good. So I don't really know. I kind of would like to check it out, if I'm honest. And I've seen, as we've discussed, we'll probably talk about the new Halloween.
Mm.
Halloween. I kind of felt like the original one was always going to win this, right? I kind of, and it did by quite a margin, I think, did it? Or
yeah, Yeah, I mean, yes, definitely. I think it's, I think it was, yeah, I think it was bound to, because, well, I mean, it's, I just see the others as pointless. It's kind of like the remaking Halloween is a bit like, well, it's a bit like remaking Halloween, really, isn't it? It's like, why, why? I mean, it, you know.
I will say that about the Rob Zombie one is like, this looks, this is, Malcolm McDowell's a great choice, but it's like, this is the same film, so. Mm. Okay, so not to the degree of the, you know, the, remember like the Gus Van Sant version of Psycho, where it was like, well, this is just Psycho. Not that degree of stuff, but it looks kind of similar enough to make me think like, well, why are we doing this?
Yeah. just very quickly, my dad sent us £10 2 days ago. Thanks, Dad.
Hey. Cheers, Philip.
Getting in early. Andrew Capit sent us £10. Thank you, Andrew. He says, hey fellas, have you seen the recent Bruce Willis Die Hard battery advert? I enjoyed it more than the last two movies.
Have you seen
no.
it?
No, I haven't.
It was yeah, so Argyle's in it, and they have the Twinkie stash as well. Yeah, it was, they did loads of trailers and stuff.
Cashback.
Duncan's missing things because he's busy dadding, whereas I'm just still looking at the internet all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah, they kept doing that. They trailed it, and it's like Die Hard is back, and it's like, oh, what's this mean? And then it was like, there's a brand of batteries called Die Hard. It's an advert for Die Hard the batteries. Right. And it was just a bit like, okay. Like, it was quite fun. I got to say, it was quite fun. It was like a little short film, but also at the same time, it's kind of like just sort of sad and whorish.
Yeah,
you know, you just what have you got left, really? After that, it was quite, it was kind of fun. I feel very bad because he's kind of gone like, "What do you think?" And I'm just kind of like, whorish. but it was kind of fun, I must say. And it kind of did callbacks to sort of, you know, OG Die Hard.
Yeah,
but ultimately, it's just kind of like this sad, cynical old wanker, isn't it?
It's a shame, man, because it's, you know. Bruce Willis. There's so much to love about him in terms of his movies, but
well, he was the guy that I think the saddest thing about that is that he was the guy with the, he was always the guy with a twinkle in his eye, wasn't he?
Mm.
And to see him so kind of
whorish,
just miserable, and you know,
yeah. I mean, to have a career that most actors would kill for, and then to kind of be annoyed about it is just a bit.
Yeah. Look at all this success. Mm. I hate it.
Mm.
And you know, like being mean to a fucking like some, you know, some ITV presenter like schlepping it on the breakfast shift.
Yeah,
and he's just being an arsehole to them. It's like, give over, mate. Come on, like really?
Yeah.
You know, is that the person you want to take this out on? Just because Ashton Kutcher stepping your wife or?
Sam Montgomery sent us £5. He says, hi guys, looking forward, not a mad slash a fan. I think it means fan. But every October I watch Halloween. Just watched The Lighthouse, really liked it. Would like thoughts.
Thoughts. Have you watched I'm gonna watch The Lighthouse this weekend, I think.
Oh, okay. Is it on
that's kinda neat.
Streaming service?
It's on now.
Oh, okay,
Ivan
cool.
Tells me it's on now, so it's watchable. Yeah,
I'd like to watch it. It's just one of those films I think would take a lot of cajoling to get my wife to watch.
I see. Yeah,
and I've already promised Mark that I'm going to watch June Drifters tomorrow night. So,
fuck.
Yeah,
I was talking to Mark yesterday. He sent me June Drifter to watch like a while ago, and I didn't watch it yet because I'm absolute fucking. He sent me a film that's not out and said, like, hello, my friend. Would you like to see my feature film before everyone else? I kind of went, yeah, and then didn't watch it because I'm a cunt.
Yeah.
That's us demonetized. bless him. So, yeah, I should watch that as well, actually.
I might get two in. We'll see. We'll see if I can manage to. But I'm babysitting, so.
Right. Well, yeah. There's two things. In terms of sort of nautically themed black and white films, there's The Lighthouse that came out, and around a similar time there's an English film called Bait, set in like a Cornish fishing town. Have you heard about that?
No.
It's in the style of the kind of British New Wave, and it's kind of like, I think it's in 4x3, it's this, and I think they've dubbed it and stuff and shot on 16mm film, I believe. And it's about like the gentrification of this Cornish fishing town. I think it's released by the BFI. And when it came out, I was just like, wow, that looks fucking cool.
Mm.
And Ivan went and saw it in the picture house and said it was, he confirmed it was in fact cool. And I really want to watch it. So that, I thought, probably watch that and Bait as a kind of black and white 2019 nautical film double bill.
Fair enough.
In fact, very much the deep impact to the Lighthouse's Armageddon.
Yeah, it's weird that those things get revived at the same time, isn't it? I'm not sure what that's about. But
yeah, funny. I mean, have you had any... I've had one quite major part of the Lighthouse spoiled for me by a GIF.
Oh,
I feel like you would... The sea, you know what I mean? Thing.
Is it a seagull? I did. Yeah, I saw that. I've no idea what the context is or what why that happened.
No. Yeah. It's kind of like, in a way, it's like, will knowing the context spoil that? Because on its own, it's amazing. Yeah. It's the most brilliant thing I've ever seen. Oh, it's Robin Battenbat battering a seagull.
Ooh, Robin with, Battenbat.
Yeah, Robin Battenbat, because he's Batman, isn't he? Oh, so it's Robin Battenbat.
Is that the version of Batfleck? That's like his version of Batfleck.
I think that's what Ivan kept saying, and I've just adopted it badly. Just done my... This coat's really nice. This is Ivan's coat. It's really nice. Got my hands in the pockets. Feeling quite... Oh, what's this? And that's the end of a packet of Rizla. Very on-brand detritus for Ivan. Not the spider, though, because he is arachnophobic. This was part of his Columbo get-up.
Oh, nice. Okay, cool.
He did like an uncharacteristically lanky Columbo.
I was going to say, quite, yeah.
A two-eyed, 6'4" Columbo.
very good.
Christ. Yes. Cool. I'm just finding my level. I'm just going to say this once so I can take the coat off. I shot him six times! There you go. There's Halloween 2 for you. I think it's pretty sure it's Halloween 2 where he says that. I've got to take layers. Fuck a duck.
Whoa. You went all out and put the jacket on underneath as well for authenticity.
Yeah, man, I got my tweed. The only thing is, like, my only kind of fat tie is like this tartan one, which is a very nice tie, which an ex-girlfriend bought me. But it's not on brand for Dr. Loomis's tie. But I think people just saw a bald cunt in a coat and just went, Dr. Loomis, nice Halloween, pretty good. You know, if you missed my cosplay, you can always scroll back. The month of cosplays is over. This is it.
Yes. Yeah. As you can see, I partook but once.
Yeah, it was great though. I loved our Brundle cosplays. It's really, particularly because it was completely unsignposted. So it's just a bit like, what's going on? I don't understand.
Why are they just like Mr. Bean and or
and or Dirty Harry?
But definitely not Seth Brundle.
I'm looking forward to some Fly 2 action actually this weekend. Quite excited to watch.
Oh,
that.
You're gonna watch it? Yeah. Well. See, that's another thing I need to watch. I've got this endless list of films I really need to watch. That and They Live. Many things I need to watch. There you go.
So many things to watch. Yeah. I think I'd be. Ivan's been very good at. He was like, "Oh, we have to watch Halloween films." And it's kind of like, "Yeah, I'm all for that." And someone asked in the gaming stream on Saturday, like, "What have you watched?" And he's been writing them down. And it turns out we've watched 17. Well, now as of because I got him to put Dawn of the Dead on this week for me. For reasons, and that I think that puts us up to 18 movies, which I realise some people do one a day, but yeah, we've clipped through them, man. We've had a good old run.
Wow.
Yeah.
Do you feel are you depraved like the video nasties proponents would have us believe?
Yeah, man, I've been worshipping Satan all over the place. You wouldn't believe it. But any time there's a break in my schedule, I just worship Satan in some small way.
You bay at the moon.
And... bay at the moon. I cut the throat of an ant because I didn't have a goat available. And that's the nearest ascension. I don't know how well.
Bummed its thorax.
Bummed it.
Or something.
You couldn't really bum it. You'd have to take a fistful of ants and bum that. I'm not sure you can strip bum it. So. A live ant fleshlight, if you will. Right, let's go to the chat. Dan Lyle saying Donald Pleasance went to his school. He's mentioned that a few times. But Donald Pleasance went to Dan Lyle. No, Dan Lyle didn't go to Donald Pleasance's school. Donald Pleasance went to Dan Lyle's school.
Exactly.
I know that's not how linear time works, but it doesn't matter because Dan's the true celebrity here.
He went to the Lyle School of Hard Knocks.
and Syrup, presumably. Spelled differently. It's a homonym. 115 people.
Well, wow,
so our social media snafu hasn't done too badly.
Yeah, I was going to say, not bad considering the misdirection. Very good.
Every time I lift up my beer, the camera autofixes in the bottom of the bottle. If this was in 3D, that would be such a spectacular effect to behold. But you know, it isn't. Let's have a look. Who's in the chat? I feel like we neglected the chat a little bit. I'll do my name reading off.
Do your name check. Yeah.
Do my name check. Okay. Andrew Kay, Ben Riddings, Benjamin Doughty, Benny Leonard, Dan Lars, Daniel, David Bobson, Harry Vitter, Henry Glennon, Hobo Joe 83, I Am Snorlax, John Doe, Kev Hart, Marco Marin, Mike Garside, Lewis Taylor just popped in, Kev Hart just popped in, I Am Snorlax just popped in. Oh my God, they're going quicker than I can read them. Doug Wannacott just popped in. Mr. HEC 381991, Phil Rob 1978, Rob Myers, Randall Wendell Official, Rotten to the Core, Ryan Ricardo, hey Ryan, Sam Montgomery, hey Sam, Sam Kisane, Stephen Allen, Val Verde Broadcasting, that's you and I, and Worms T17, hey Nikki, what's going on? Bicolored Prawn just popped in. I cannot keep up, they're popping all over the place here. If I missed you, I'm sorry. I apologize. Oh God, we just had a double super chat. Do you want to do all the double super chats?
Oh, yeah. Okay. Randall Windle Official says, hey, Duncan, what's your guitar model and who are your musical influences? Also, you're quite handsome. I'm drunk.
You're in there, mate.
Yeah. I'm more drunk than I handsome I am. I don't know. That's one of those drunk spoonerisms that I can't quite. Oh well, Dad, if you're still in the chat, I remember Dad telling me a very funny alcoholic spoonerism story, which I may have told before, but I think it was you, Dad, wasn't it? I'm sure you're right, that he got pulled over with some friends in a car in the 60s when it wasn't permissible to drink drive, but certainly it wasn't as
people fucking did it
though. People did it, yeah. And his mate wound down the window and went, good afternoon, Consternoon. And the guy drove back. Now, the bit about that should be shocking is the fact that it was in the afternoon, not the evening. There we are. My guitar is I don't know the model. It's a Garrett guitar, which has a lovely sound. Dad actually bought that for me back when I was playing in bands, which was about 11 years ago, or more, in fact, probably about 12 years ago. And it's a lovely set. I think they're a Canadian brand guitar, but it's made out of a really lovely wood, and it has a really lovely sound, especially when it's plugged in. One of the reasons why I went for it was because I wanted it for performing live, and it has a really nice sound when it's plugged in and when it's not. But it is a very sort of warm sound, and I use Didario strings, like light gauge Didario strings, steels, and it's lovely. Bronze Phosphor. Very, very nice guitar. And who are my musical influences? As I discussed the other week, I mean, I'm quite a big Dave Matthews fan. He's kind of how I got to guitar. He's how I kind of forced myself into kind of learning guitar. I learned guitar basically through following Dave Matthews tabs, which if anyone who knows guitar and knows Dave Matthews would say is a stupid thing to do. And it was, but that's kind of how I got into it. And then I have lots of quite random ones that I pick up and I kind of get obsessed over for a while and then kind of come back to you later. But I was always a big fan of people like Paul Simon. Who else? I love anything. Like I love some Queen, some... is it Toto? I kind of rediscovered. I like finding bands like Toto, and you know, you love all their hits, but then when you kind of delve into their B-sides... there's actually some pretty amazing stuff in there. Just tons of it. Monty Montgomery is a guy I've kind of discovered recently, who's this insanely good guitarist. And part of one of the things I don't like about it is I can't sit there and work out what he's doing, because he just does these insane techniques that are half picking, half slapping, half just harmonics and all kinds of craziness. If you haven't heard of him, go check him out. It's just Monty Montgomery. He's amazing. But yeah, so I've kind of been listening a lot to him recently, and I like discovering music that most people haven't heard of, in a way. I feel bad for them because it's kind of like you didn't have much of a career, but I love it because it's like my own little thing. So there you go.
That is appropriate to John Carpenter, because we all love this stuff, but it did fuck all for him when it was happening.
Yeah.
You know, bless him. It really. We had another one from Bicolor Prawn, which mm-hmm. I'm going to have to explain.
Okay.
Evening, gents. Richard, do you think Mr. Pibb will make an appearance tonight? Right, well.
Is he talking about Ivan?
The funny part is, under my Donald Pleasance costume, I'm just wearing joggers, so I could very well get my willy out. I'm not going to. That's not how we're going to get demonetized. Mr. Pibb is something that's been occurring on the gaming streams over the last few weeks, and Mr. Pibb is like a knockoff Dr. Pepper that's very common in the States. Like, you could just go and get a Mr. Pibb. Like, here you don't really get knockoff Dr. Peppers except for in the supermarkets. And Ivan said it sounded like a kind of creepy 70s children's character, and we've just been on the, because they're horror-themed streams, going like, hello, boys and girls, I live inside your skin, and stuff like that. and I've just had to explain it, because you don't know what it is. Someone's given money to ask if Mr. Pibb's going to come. It's going to, like, that would be deeply confusing to Duncan. Well, I suppose technically Mr. Pibb has disappeared, so there you go.
There you go.
He's technically, he's here. Mr. Pibb is here. That's what's been going on the gaming streams. Not sure if there'll be. There might be one this weekend, not on Saturday, because Ivan and I are having Halloween larks. But then maybe on Sunday we might do one, because I think he's taking the Monday off. So we might do one.
Cool.
Unclear at the present time for gaming stream this weekend.
We watched this week. My wife and I have been in between screaming bouts watching Chernobyl. Because we hung up with Chernobyl, or as I like to call it, how communism bombed Eastern Europe.
how I learned to stop worrying and love bombing Eastern Europe. supposed to be fucking like extra great though. I just haven't had a chance to watch it.
It's bloody marvellous. Yeah, no, it really is great. It's one of those, you have to make that adjustment every time you watch it, because no one's speaking Russian unless they're on a radio. And no one is speaking with a Russian accent. Everyone's got English or American accents. It's like no one cares what the accent is. So it's one of those just like, just go with it. Like, you know, you've got Jared Harris just speaking like Jared Harris, and Stellan Skarsgård sounds Swedish or whatever. You know, it's like, it just go with it. But it is good. Apart from that, it's really, because it's funny, because you've got these like northern people walking around going like, oh, comrade, like, let's go down and, you know, like, oh, you know,
bloody communism, eh?
Yeah, let's go to the Pripyat swimming pool or whatever. And it's like, right. But it's, you know, sort of going like, comrade Yamatovovich will tell us about that. And it's like, that's weird. But you know what? It's one of those, like, you feel like actually it's probably better that you didn't make everyone do a Russian accent, because, it takes away the authenticity. It's one of those things where sometimes that can be a barrier, I think. And it's like when someone's focusing on the accent more than they are the performance, it's kind of like, and actually, do you know what, as well, in a weird way, because it's HBO and it's kind of being told through Western eyes, it kind of, it's like the character's voice is having Western accent.
Making people, your options are own accents, everyone speaks English with a Russian accent, which is just as ridiculous, really.
Yeah.
Or you just do it all in Russian and try and sell it to the English market, English speaking market, which is insane.
Mm.
So I'm just, because like the Snowman, the Make a Fast Manner movie, the notoriously awful Joe Nesbo, I think it's a Joe Nesbo adaptation, is set in Norway. And everyone speaks English with English accents, including like J.K. Simmons' English accent and stuff. And I'm kind of like, well, fine, and it's consistent.
Mm.
So I mean, that film has a lot of problems, and that was not the root of it at all. And I think Enemy at the Gates, isn't that like the Germans are all American and the Russians are all English, except Ron Perlman, who's had some kind of atomic stroke, is like, hello bloody blimey, I'm only a bleeding Russian sniper, so I am chim chim charoo, as much as I love him.
Could be. Well, because I mean, it's things like the Girl with the Dragon Tattoo Fincher version, everyone's doing a really great where is that set? Is that Sweden? No. Where is it? Is it Sweden?
I've never seen the Norway? Fincher one. I
can't remember. Everyone's doing a really convincing Scandinavian accent, including Robin Wright and Christopher Plummer, people like that. But Daniel Craig, who's the central character, whose surname is Lundqvist or whatever, is just like, hello, cool blimey, governor. I am... whatever it is, like, you know, I'm in Scandinavia, apples and pears, and it's like, but really, you couldn't do that.
I'm a Scandinavia, apples and pears.
That's, I believe, a direct quote from the film. But yes, but a good film. I have seen both versions, and my preference is for that one. I mean, I know that's sacrilege, but fuck off. I don't care.
I've definitely reached that point myself with a lot of things where I used to have like real opinions about stuff, and I'm just kind of like, don't care.
I really don't. I mean,
Guess what? We're all going to die at some point. Who cares?
I know. I looked at
now. I've got really strong opinions about this cartoon. Everyone you know is going to die.
I looked at my daughter the other day and I was just like, you're going to bury me. Just like, you know, but then that's, you know, that's the way it should be.
Right. Can we crack on? Mm-hmm. Just because I've had some people say to me, they get a bit annoyed where they don't know when to start the film. So I put on the countdown. The film starts roughly 45 minutes in.
Okay.
So would you mind to count in and we'll just crack on? I'm sorry. That seems so workmanlike, doesn't it?
No, not at all.
God, let's get it over with.
I'm just going to get set up here. Whoa. That's Borat yelling at me on the fucking advert. Bugger
off. Yes.
I've not seen that. but this is not the Borat stream, so that's not talking about.
That's another thing altogether.
Mm, right, volume is down. I am at timestamp zero. We'll probably go out of sync, but we're both watching it on Prime, yes?
We're both on Prime, so yeah, we should be all right.
Okay, all right. Let's count down from however many number of Halloween films there are, 2023.
Science.
Yeah. No, let's go from five. Okay. Five, four, three. Actually, do you know what? I'm going to stop. I'm going to do it. I did a voice for Caudry FX, his new Halloween special that's dropping.
I'm quite keen to hear this, actually.
Yeah, so I did a sort of Dracula type thing. I didn't have much time to put it on. He sort of said Bela Lugosi, but when I looked up Bela Lugosi, it's one of those, like, the impression of Bela Lugosi is not, everyone's like, oh, I want to suck your blood. And it's like, he was just like, I am Dracula. I am in the 50s, so I sound like that. You know, it wasn't really, you know. So, but I'll
your
do the
passion bleeds through.
Yes. A five, a four, a three, a two, a one, go. There we go.
Halloween. Have you seen Ed Wood, the Tim Burton film? Martin Landau. Martin Landau as Bela Lugosi is wonderful.
Oh,
good. Yeah, he's so good. And there's bits with him sort of expressing his dissatisfaction the guy who played Frankenstein all the time. His name's just going to...
Boris Karloff. Yeah.
Using slurs that I shan't repeat.
I'm
going to put my costume back on for the start of the film.
Okay.
And see how long I last. I'm really happy with this costume. Because I haven't had the coat and I put it on. I was kind of like, this kind of rocks.
Yeah,
this
man
is great. It's fucking... I'm wearing like my running shoes and joggers on the bottom. But it's like reading the news, isn't it? They'll just sit with their dicks and fannies out, presumably.
Dicks and or fannies.
And or fannies.
It's this OP where it's like Donald Pleasance in. It's like, right. Like, yeah.
Luckily, that kind of went his way because he essentially led this until the sixth film, didn't he? Like, Dr. Loomis became like that. Oh, God, yeah. Like, it was all about him, really, as it kind of wore on.
Oh, okay.
Late great Deborah Hill there. I do love this title sequence. I love the pumpkin just sat there. It's really neat. And the tell you what, I don't know the name of this font. Let's talk typeface. But they really, like, now every time I say that font, it's just like Halloween. It's Halloween font. Yeah, it was being in orange as well.
Cool.
Still waiting to see Jackson dress up as Hudson Hawk, says Worms. I can make that happen. I don't think I've got 90s Bruce Willis moves, but I can make that happen. It's just a black t-shirt. I do that most days. So Halloween then. What I know, because this is a thing, this is held in very, very high esteem among slasher fans. To me, it's one of the lesser golden era John Carpenters. Probably just because I'm sick of it, because I watched it so much when I was younger, and perhaps it just loses. And I think it's one of these things that's been spoiled by the trends that followed it as well.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't watched it to death. I've watched it a few times and found it to be pretty effective. I think it's a really great film. I suppose of all the kind of slasher, the kind of 70s, 80s slasher stuff, it's the one with the most... It's funny because it's like it's made by John Carpenter, and yet what it's turned into, or what it's tried to turn into, is the one with the sort of highfalutin, arty pretensions about it, you know, as a series. It's like, and then it culminates in the most recent one where it's like full of its own farts. Like it's so fart huffingly like portentous, and you know, and you're kind of like, what? This was always just a slasher film, but it inspired so many things.
Yeah, and the thing is, it's the slasher film. I think that's the important thing.
Yeah.
It's John Carpenter, so it's so brilliantly made, and it's so tense, and it's so well constructed. Mm. It's just sort of like once you've, it's like eating the best beef burger in the world. Ultimately, it's still a beef burger.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It doesn't matter if it's made of Kobe beef and fucking angels' dicks or whatever. It's still ultimately a burger.
Yeah.
This is a shit analogy. This, oddly enough, this sequence is one of the first things we watched in year one film studies.
Okay.
Was very kind of like, because this is a POV sequence, and it was in when we were first, you know, one of the first things we did in like the first term is like, okay, we're going to talk about the difference between objectivity and subjectivity, and how can films synthesize the subjectivity of a character's perspective, and one of the most basic ways, of course, is POV. And this is that, because, and it's very good because it's done also in like a super wide lens as well, so it feels a bit more like human vision. And I think you have he pulls the mask over his head, right, and you see it come down over his eyes from within his own head.
Yeah, something like that. Or did he take it off? I can't remember.
One or the other, right? I can't remember if it's, yeah, just before he goes to murder the shit out of his sister.
Steve Allen says in Duncan's Billy Connolly voice, "It's a wee boy."
That makes it seem so sweet.
I know, yeah.
"It's a wee boy."
Billy Connolly could read fucking Mein Kampf and it would sound sort of somehow wholesome.
It's endearing.
Because he got away for years saying to grannies and stuff like, "Fucking bullshit, you cunt." And these grannies are like, "Oh.
No.
Because I'm not fucking like, no." It's all right. You know.
Yeah, my dad met Billy Connolly at the Cambridge Folk Festival. He had to escort him around because my dad used to volunteer there. He said he was a lovely man.
No, I bet he was. I bet he is.
Them's just the science facts.
Yeah.
So this is, oddly enough, I was, so cinematography by Dean Cundey, who did a few things with Carpenter, did Jurassic Park, did the Back to the Futures. And I was kind of like, a lot of DOPs do this, but to me, those kind of blues, those twilight blues are very much something I associate with him.
Okay.
There's a lot of that in this movie. They're kind of like soft, kind of twilight blue. And I'm just writing a review of DC Cab, which is like this really camp sort of like episodic comedy caper, which was directed by Schumacher and has photography by Dean Cundey in 1983 after this. And the nighttime scenes actually do look rather a lot like the ones from Halloween. And the tone is complete. I mean, it's got Mr. T in it and peak cocaine Gary Busey. It's a very, very different tone.
Yeah.
Like, you know, completely different tone.
Oh, you just pulled the mask over.
There you go. It's lovely wee clown suit.
Hey, oh, look at her breasts. I don't know why I said that.
Breasts.
Wee jobby.
Michael Myers, wee jobby.
He murders his sister and then he does a wee jobby.
Of course, it's really important to imagine the character's perspective as Michael Myers defecates and then checks the bowl to see his leavings before flushing them. It's his a very important move. It's leavings. Look, this is the high quality content you expect from Val Verde Broadcasting. Week in, week out.
Week being the optimum.
Yes, indeed. It's a homophobe.
That's the word of the day.
I think I did it last week as well.
Did you?
I think it's my, yeah, that's what I'm all about at the moment.
That's a wee boy, look. There he is.
Oh, hey,
with his lad in his hand.
His lad in his hand. I mean, that would be Freudian if his lad was in his hand. Yeah. Just to add to your, you know, if you're at home, just imagine, I'm quite hot, so I'm going to roll my tracksuit bottoms up to my knees. Imagine, what does that look like, I wonder?
Try and vent through his shins. The shins are...
I do have freakishly large legs,
that's
as you know.
True, yeah.
So in terms of exposing surface area, it's probably the most efficient way to expel heat.
I hope they're not too hairy.
That's true. That would be counter to my plan. Yeah, so have you got any thoughts on Halloween 3, by the way?
I don't think I've seen.
Non-Michael Myers.
Is that the one in the asylum or something?
It's in a kind of, it's in a town where there's kind of like an evil toy company, essentially.
No, then I haven't seen that.
It's because there's no Michael Myers in it.
Right.
Because the idea after, right, the idea after two was to take it in a kind of anthology direction because they felt they'd done what they had with Michael Myers in them.
Yeah.
I think quite how they wanted to and it came back around. I've got a feeling a lot of people in the chat are going to talk about Halloween 3. I think Ross Sanders is mentioning that. It's look, there's me. It's really great. Halloween 3 is really great. It's a really great, got Tom Atkins in it. It's kind of produced by Carpenter. So it's like a fake Carpenter. This is the photography's called like Carpenter. It's got some electronic music and stuff in it. It's really good, man. And it's something that it's not like you're on a Majesty's Secret Service contrarian type thing. I think lots of people really like it. It just didn't do very well,
right?
And it's kind of a shame because I honestly don't know how much you can do with Michael Myers having watched all of these. And if they had been able to parlay that into kind of an anthology thing, I think that would have been really, really cool. And again, I hate just saying to you, watch that. So I'll add that to the endless list of things I have to watch in between keeping a tiny human alive. Yeah, cheers, Rich. I'll get right on that.
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, it is tough to watch stuff at the moment. But I mean, yeah, I do want to watch films. I want to go to the cinema as well, but fuck, chance of that.
Well, if it makes you feel any better, I don't think there's a lot of that about at the moment. Mm. You know, it's not just...
Well, fucking hell, I want to go and make it. You know, I want to be out there shooting stuff, but...
I've nearly finished the screenplay for this short.
Oh, shit.
I'm 2/3 of the way through, actually. Shot. Would you like shot? Not shot. It might be a shot. Let's see when it comes out. It could be a complete shot. Yeah, no, I'm 2/3 of the way through with that. It's been I've been powwowing with Bill about getting it done.
Nice.
Bill is our financier.
Yeah.
I'm just going to replicate Donald Pleasance's stance for this shot. I should have filmed the stream in a car.
but he's doing it as if he was in the UK on the left hand side of the car.
On the left hand side of the car. Yeah. See what I mean about that kind of it's a very content. It's not just a Dean Cundey thing, but like the blue kind of twilight thing.
Yeah.
He does it, and this film has quite a lot of it. Because I did think today about doing a Dean Cundey thing. And I thought, you know what? No, I'm just gonna kind of go hyper on my usual lights and do kind of fancy shit with that instead. Because I looked at some frames from Halloween, and I was gonna copy some Halloween. I went, you know what? Why not have pink?
Yeah,
yeah.
Fair enough.
Why not? Oh, yeah. So some are saying that the new Halloween trailer is out for the new one. Halloween Kills is the next.
What? Halloween. There's another one.
Yeah, there's two more.
What? Well, so is this number 3 and 4 that are coming down the pipe?
Yep. Right. Yep. And like the end to the most recent Halloween was like, well, okay. I mean, I get the point was that like, I mean, if their frustration with the other sequels that they didn't like and had to replace was that they just kept killing Michael Myers and bringing him back, well...
Yeah, and also like, you know, it frustrates me as well because it's like, you set up Laurie Strode as like having spent 40 years being the, you know, being a sort of Michael Myers-aphobe or a file. And like, you know, she knows everything about him, she knows his prison movements, she knows all that. Surely she should know better than to leave him in a burning building and not witness his death and just stare at him down a thing. It's like shoot him a load of times, keep shooting him. Shoot him, then burn him alive. Like, I don't get it. Her whole plan was like set fire to the entire house. It's like, why don't you just set fire to the basement
with him in it, and then shoot him while he's on fire, shoot him after he's on fire, bury him, dig him up, shoot him again, burn him again, and shoot him, and then bury him.
Yeah. So like, I thought that film kind of established like it blew off some of his, you know, he was mortal. So it's like, yes, you know.
Well, that's the thing about him, because I think it's Halloween 6. Halloween 6 is Paul Rudd's first feature.
Yeah.
So Rudd and Pleasance crossing over. Yeah. Paul Rudd, of course, looking exactly the same as he does now. Paul Rudd is a portrait of Paul Rudd or whatever. But they kind of, that in Halloween 6, I think they say his birth was influenced by like a satanic cult or something, so that's why he's kind of magic. Because this Halloween, it's just a nutter. Like, and so I get in the second one, the David Gordon Green one, the new one, he's just a guy. Mm. And sort of going like, oh, he had his fingers blown off, so he's mortal. And it's like, yeah, but you just dropped a house on him and he's going to come back in the next one.
Yeah.
Unless it's not him in the next one. And it's the copycat. And it's just you're falling into all the traps that all these films always fell into.
Well, exactly, because that's all you can do. I mean, it's not... Again, it's I think the problem, the mistake that all these films made was to prioritise the monster. You know, the monster, especially in all slasher films, is that he's a plot device. He's the thing you've got to get away from. It's just an allegory for death. It's like, why do we have to have backstories? And, oh, you know, it was a seance. I mean, for fuck's sake. It's like, the point is he represents death. If you try and make him represent anything else, you've just lost the plot immediately. You've tied yourself in knots.
Yes. And I think the thing is with Halloween as well, it stayed so po-faced all the time.
Mm.
It was just... Donald Pleasance was great in all of them. He just carried them. Mm. Like, absolutely. But it was so po-faced. And that's what I kind of like about... I'm glad that Jason went to space. You know what I mean? Because you realise what you're doing and sort of run with it rather than kind of go like, oh no, this is about mortality. And it's like, well, it was. Now it's about the man that gets blown up and shot and stabbed and... whatever all the time. Steve Allen's asking for a timestamp. You guys are a little bit behind us, but my timestamp, I'm going to give you a moment to be ready. My timestamp is 14:15. I hope that helps. I don't know.
I'm a couple of seconds ahead of you, I think, but near enough. Laurie Strode is striding down the road.
Laurie Strode, where?
As Michael Myers, and is wearing a boiler suit. Hello.
Hello.
As Laurie Strode, down the path.
Ah, look how lovely he's gone behind the edge.
He's gonna do a murder.
He's gonna do a murder.
Why is it her that he's bothered about? I never really got.
It's something, and this is something that the sequels then piled onto, that they're secretly brother or sister and blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
That was all forgotten about. But it's just crazy and evil and fixated, isn't he? I suppose that's the thing. And he's chosen his victim, and that's that.
Donald Pleasance is such a great actor, but I always found his Blofeld really perplexing to me. Like, I was like, why did you make that choice? He's like this spaced out stoner kind of like.
He's quite staccato, isn't he? He's like, goodbye, Mr. Bond.
Yeah, when he does that, it's like, right? Like, what? Really?
Right?
So Terrence Young didn't have notes. I was like, are you what you'd want? Be the nicotine that kills you, Mr. Bond. It's like, no, it'll be the tar and the carcinogens in the cigarettes.
It is addictive, but it's not toxic.
It's a very strange read of it. I mean, I don't think anyone's... I actually think Telly Savalas is probably the person who got Blofeld maybe the most right in terms of characterization. Although, I think Christoph Waltz actually does a better job than he gets credit for, but...
He's a tremendous actor.
He's just a good actor, yeah.
This is just reminding me of something, actually, on the link to television Savalas, give him his full name. First things first, Jay Weatherford, $5. Thank you very much. Did Dr. Loomis go into hiding, change his name, become president, turn New York City into a prison from which he then had to be rescued?
Yeah.
I think so, shared universe, yeah. Then he also found a Prince of Darkness.
He also he didn't age for like 35 years or whatever.
Yes, to space year 1997.
Yeah.
So on the gaming stream on Saturday, we're playing Resident Evil. Adrian Mendoza, I don't know if Adrian Mendoza is here, but he said you guys should watch Horror Express. It's on YouTube because it's out of copyright. You can watch it in HD, and it stars Peter Cushing, Christopher Lee, and Television Savalas. I say Television Savalas because that's a joke that Viz made 20 years ago, and I keep repeating as if it's going to get funny again, which one day. And so we were kind of like, oh, neat. Okay, so it's a Spanish production, English language film. Lee and Cushing, awesome. Telly Savalas, great, you know. And we were watching it and kind of like, it's weirdly reminiscent of The Thing. I mean, okay. Like, this has a lot with The Thing, because it turns out the creature like came from space and has memories of ancient times when he's trapped on Earth. And looked it up, found a video of Joe Dante talk about it. It was really cool. But then it turns out it actually is based upon the Joseph W. Campbell short Who Goes There.
Right.
And it's completely different because it's set on the, it's also known as Horror on the Trans-Siberian Express. So it's set on a train.
Oh, okay.
And it's a different version of the, it's like a secret version of the thing that no one talks about.
That's pretty cool.
Man, it's really good. Like, again, I add that to the list of things you can't watch. But dude, and because it's on YouTube for free, so you can just go watch it. And that's a big thanks to Adrian Mendoza who brought that up on Saturday night.
What's it called, Horror Express?
Just Horror Express, yeah. Okay. And yeah, we were watching it kind of like, oh, this is weird similarities to that. And then afterwards shopped around. I was like, well, fuck a duck. Like, no shit between the Howard Hawks produced version and the John Carpenter version was this kind of Euro set on the Trans-Siberian Express version with Telly Savalas as a Cossack. Again, just doing an American accent.
Of course. Comes,
I'm a fucking Cossack.
Brett Pritchard, I feel at pains, I must read this out. He's quite right. He says, Duncan, you know very well Terence Young didn't direct You Only Live Twice. It was Lewis Gilbert, of course.
Lewis Gilbert, who went on to make the same film 1,000 times. It was basically like, this time it's original because it's instead of a spaceship eating another spaceship, it's a tanker eats another tanker, and then there's a nuclear bomb and a layer. And then
so the man did James, a lot of Bond stuff and did
James
the same thing.
James Bond wins.
Yeah, basically it was...
James Bond wins.
It was You Only Live Twice, which involves a space shuttle eating another space shuttle. It was A Spy Who Loved Me, which involves a tanker eating another tanker. And then it was Moonwaker, which was obviously Moonwaker. So it was, that was the Jonathan Ross version of Moonraker.
And just to be clear, he was Alfie the pub boy from the far show.
James Bond,
spy,
tanker, is it? Eating another tanker. Mug's
game. I used to eat tankers. Hardest game in the world.
35 years, man and boy.
He does sort of sound like that, but when he sort of rolls his R's, he can't. So he's like Moonwaker. But by all accounts, a lovely man who is now dead.
Oh, there you go.
we're talking about the futility of
I'm loving tonight's weirdly fatalistic, but it's a film about death, so why not? Let's just be weirdly fatalistic.
Let's do it.
Oh no, I'm dead in a bush lake. So films, films, is it? Yeah.
Laurie Strode.
Imagine if someone's just like in the future where we can just insert anyone into any film, like Alfie the pub boy in Halloween.
Deep fakes are coming as Laurie Strode.
Murderer.
Daniel Hawkins says, "Hey guys, it's my birthday. Happy birthday, Daniel.
Go and party like it's your birthday."
Please do go and party like it's your birthday. Don't sit here listening to us talk about Alfie the pub.
One of my friends said to me, I think I said the day, I saw my friend Kat, I haven't seen her for a while. So what are we going to do? And it's like, well, there's nothing to do anymore. So we went to play pool like a couple of teenagers because it's anything that's like open. You know what I mean? So we went to play pool for a bit.
My birthday got cancelled this year as well. It's right at the start of lockdown and it was just like,
She was like, what you got planned for your birthday this year? And I was kind of like, none. Like, you know what am I gonna do? Like
sitting at home with my pregnant wife, who can't.
If it's
drink.
A Thursday, it'd probably be a fucking stream, wouldn't it?
I was looking forward to abusing the her mandated designated driver status for 9 months, but unfortunately, it just didn't come to pass.
Hoping to develop kidney disease.
to be on dialysis at least once.
knock her up again, mate. Easy peasy.
Oh God, no, hell no.
Totally worth it.
9 months of debauchery, liver killing debauchery.
Debauchera.
There were some words that just are so naughty. It's like debauchery or on the lamb. That just
on the
just
lamb.
Sounds so naughty. You know, he's on the lamb.
On the lambs. He's on the lamb. It's got a nice kind of Depression era vibe to it, hasn't it?
Yeah, you just have this image of someone like running across cornfields going like,
I'm debauching.
Yes.
And it's debauchery. Debauchery. Yeah. It's just a nice word to say.
Yeah. Pillaging as well. That sounds like fun.
Pillaging. A big pile of Viking fun. Oh, holy shit. We got 155 people watching. Jesus Christ. Hey, guys. It's been a while since we had these numbers. We're not even talking about the fucking film. Jesus, they're here for the... They're here for a man sweating in a trench coat. That's what they're here for.
That's it.
And his annoying autofocus going off every 5 seconds, which I might have to get up and deal with because it's fucking doing my head in.
It's POV, right? I mean, that's the general gist of this film, is it's kind of through someone's eyes all the time. Is that right?
I think it's certainly a big part of it. I mean, there's this period where, like, I know because Carpenter was... shot everything in Panavision, is that right? I could be wrong. But I think it's Academy ratio, and he used to fucking shoot like their whole film shot just super wide. So like this, there is actually mild distortion quite a lot, and you see it more. There's a lot of kind of organic in this kind of places, trees and stuff. In Escape from New York at the very beginning, when they're in that facility, you can see the walls kind of bulging. There's a kind of a barrel effect. Not to shoehorn that in. But it does, I do kind of think, because it works very well for the POV bit at the beginning, because again, you know, human vision, they have mapped the human vision to actually where it stops and stuff, like the terms of degrees vision that a human actually has.
Yeah.
And, you know, cameras are comparatively narrow. There's a famous shot where he just hides behind the hedge. So when Homer goes backwards through the hedge. And, you know, I think those wider angles do kind of simulate the human eye better. I will say this much as well. When you shoot like really wide, it really hides camera wobble, which is great for when you do any traveling stuff. I really find that really makes my life a lot easier when I put like a 14 mil on a gimbal and walk around with it, because it looks good. And you can, I'm not saying you can just go, but you know, if you did, it wouldn't look as bad.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
It's quite good.
I think it also sort of gives sense to the kind of sprawlingness of suburbia. You know, you can just see the intersection of hedges and paths that just seem to go on forever, and you know what I mean, the sort of avenues and what.
Yeah, it kind of just goes off. There's quite a few things where you just see the street go off into the horizon and stuff like that. Did you ever hear, and I'm sure some, so if you look at it, it's not October, there's leaves on the trees, but there are leaves on the ground.
Yeah.
And I understand, correct me if I'm wrong, because they didn't actually shoot in October, so it's like it's really obviously not October. But they shipped in, or they spray painted leaves brown, so the few kind of meager scatterings of leaves you see are from a collection of leaves that they had to either collect or manufacture to create the illusion of autumn.
Yeah,
which is cool. I said autumn, the illusion of autumn.
This is me, the Arnold. This is me doing the commentary to Halloween. And this is the scene with the leaves on the ground, but it's not autumn. And then Cash I put back. The baby in there.
The lady is talking to the man. They're using their mouths to make words, and they understand the sound. And then she understands the statement, and she walks away. And then she turns around. That's what his commentaries are like, isn't it?
Did the movie True Lies with Jamie Lee, and she took her clothes off, and it was fantastic.
It was fantastic. It was. Yes.
It really was.
Dude, Trading Places was a sexual awakening. Oh, Jesus, yes, Christ. God, yeah. To allow me to be chauvinist for a minute, so when she gets her baps out. Like, fucking... yes, and how?
And how?
You want to do the super chat?
I don't, but it's up to you. I can.
No, you don't. You've got a nicer voice than me.
No. Then you can. I can't do this. Mark Flanagan writes, do you think Halloween would have survived as a classic film with the endless sequels to keep it relevant? Not much love for Prom Night or Terror Train.
I think it would have done, in that it... This was one of Carpenter's biggest financial successes, right? And this was the highest grossing independent film of all time until it was knocked off by Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, which was made by Golden Harvest.
Really?
Yeah. It's crazy. Crazy fact. So this made, you know, relative to budget, I think, rather than actual gross, I'm not sure. I think it's proportional. I'm not sure, but it was. Think of all the John Carpenter films. Okay, a lot of what we love in John Carpenter didn't do well financially. And as I was a raconteur, people still love them. I really think this would have done in that all those other films as islands without sequels remain classics. You know, like The Fog and They Live and The Thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, Escape from New York did have a sequel, which I used to hate but now sort of love for probably the wrong reasons.
Well, not being someone who's really seen many of the Halloween sequels, and if I have, I've only seen parts of them. To my mind, it has always just really been this film. I mean, I know of the other ones and I have seen the most recent one, but I really don't, I don't really think of it as a series, particularly, like, not for me. I mean, this is my main experience is just this film.
Mr. HEC has just pointed out the booze globe.
Ooh.
she has a booze globe, or at least a globe. Yeah, Laurie Strode has.
Laurie Strode was like a secret alcoholic. This isn't the point that she's you know, innocent.
She's like the prissy
evil
one, isn't she?
Yeah. So she kind of represents innocence. You know, all the other teenagers are smoking and having sex and being edgy, and she just isn't. And yeah, and so
I think this is the problem with those, like, the sequel to this, the by which I mean the fucking new Halloween film. I said this about the Terminator Dark Fate as well. By ignoring everything that came before, you then fall prey to their mistakes. If you literally just ignore everything they did, you're going to end up, because, like, the new Halloween has kind of like, oh, like, some characters might as well look at the camera and go, we're going to have sex and smoke drugs, weed, and then they all die. And yeah, it's like, well, that is the cliche. And just because you're pretending you haven't seen any other slasher films or the sequels to this, it doesn't mean that's not true. You haven't, like, done the fucking Men in Black neuralizer on the whole world. Like, forget Halloween 2 onwards.
Like, I think as well, and actually, funnily enough, like, I think less so with Sarah Connor, but certainly with Laurie Strode, is the whole point as well. If you're just coming off this one, you know, she goes from being, I guess they're saying that that's a sort of character arc, but it's like in this, she's innocence. And that's what ultimately, I think, is what they're saying, is that that's what wins the day against evil, is that she is pure. Right. So, and she sort of prevails because of that. And there is a scene in the new Halloween film where Michael Myers stabs to death a woman in her home and then walks past her crying baby and doesn't kill it. So the idea, I guess, being that pure innocency, he won't touch it. But it's like, but then why is she a sort of chain smoking, swearing granny, you know, hairy assed, back saggy assed grandma, like leathery grandma with shotguns around the house, and, like, you know what I mean? Like, she's one of those, like, 9/11 truthers.
Best character bio. Yeah, she's all kind of prepper, isn't she?
Yeah, exactly.
And a lot of that is kind of like, most of the shit you've set up, you haven't even used properly.
Yeah.
Like, it's just, you didn't bother turn it on, or like, it's just kind of like you've waited 30
when you
years
see the sort of Home Alone ending where it's like, is really, that's how you thought it would go down? Is that what was supposed to happen? And it's like, your kitchen island is motorized and swings open, and inside is a Michael Myers trap.
I mean, it is a kitchen salesperson's dream, isn't it? It's kind of like, oh yeah, so it's a motorized island. It reveals this gun basement.
Yeah, I know. And but the doubles is a handy office. as well, like, you know, like, wouldn't you be a bit concerned if that was your sort of your safe haven office, but it could also set fire?
Yes. Yeah. The amount of times I could have just shot him in the face as well. So yeah. You're that well prepared. I don't know. I mean, I will say, so you haven't seen Halloween 2 either?
Not to my knowledge, no, I don't think so. We've all got sweatpants.
I would say Halloween 2...
Sorry, you can't get away with it. There's no hiding it in a blue shirt. It's Tony Blair.
You can't see mine, but yes, indeed. You can't see mine because it's under three layers, including a tweed interlayer.
Your map, your back looks like a map of the Everglades.
I look like Liam. Halloween 2 is like Rocky 2. It's not bad, but it's also like, why are we here?
Because it's just take off straight afterwards.
Yeah, follows on. So Michael disappears and then they go.
Yeah, I think I have.
That's where the line, they shot him six times. Even the director, Adam Green, said he saw me and said, I look like Dr. Loomis, and said, I shot him six times. Mostly at Gary's fucking prompting, the cunt. That's what I got the whole time I was abroad with him. It's like, oh, Loomis, you look like Loomis, you do. Like, to be fair, I put this costume on and immediately texted him a picture.
Of course
I did.
So Loomis, you bastard.
You bastard.
I shot him six times, once in the dick.
Unlike Laurie Strode in her new film, who just sort of failed and went.
I saw it with my own eyes. I blew his dick clean off.
It can't be his dick. I shot his dick six times.
Remember the Michael Myers.
So I'm guessing, because like, look how green everything is, right? And there's a great bit. The car just pulled, took a corner, and some brown leaves came down, which presumably was someone just going with like a handful of leaves like out of a tree that they'd spray painted or whatever.
Yeah, I mean, because now you mentioned it, I do remember there was a lot of talk of that. It must have been sort of in the dead of summer or something.
Okay, yeah, well, this is a thing if you shoot seasonal, isn't it?
It's always that way, though. I've always found that whenever I'm shooting for a very specific time of year, it's always the opposite. You know, I've had that where I've shot something. It's always like, I mean, like when we did Fistful of Lead, it was like, I don't think it was meant to be set like in the winter, but then because the Beast from the East came in and we were doing exteriors and there was just snow on the ground, I think Mark saw that and went like, oh, I like that. Get that in the background. That looks fantastic. And it did, and it lent an air of authenticity, but it was just like, it looked great. And I remember saying to them, I was like shivering my ass off.
Movie looked fucking awesome because of that.
Yeah. I said, there's a shot of me like shivering and stuff, but I was like, it works because whatever. And, but I did say, I was like, this is going to look amazing, but right now it's fucking miserable. Like, you know, but it is always that you go like in 3 months time, I'm not going to, all of that will have been forgotten and it will just look great. So
we've got a couple of super chats coming back to back, and I'll read them because one's directed at you, but I just wanted to address the point you've made. When we made the Night of Living Dead video, it was about 2 years ago, 2 weeks ago. So it's the middle of October essentially. And it was really hot and sunny, and I'd walked out in my black coat and I was roasting. And the thing is, the original Night of Living Dead, they wanted a sunny day, but it was very overcast. So everything's overcast at the opening scene. And I wanted, because I was doing the original film as Lynx, I wanted the overcast day, which we did not get. We had the harsh sun. And the Lynx, I think they look great. You did a really good job shooting those for me.
Thank you.
But like, they are sunny, and there's nothing I can do about that. And that's exactly the same thing that happened with the remake. The remake wanted an overcast day and they got a sunny day. So ironically, I was between the two stools in that I had the weather of the remake that I was actually talking about, but I was shooting for the Lynx for the one where they, you know what I mean? In the fucking October. And I remember, because I started editing that and I looked out the window 2 years to the day and kind of went, you fucking cunt. Because it's like overcast.
It's always the way, man. It's always the way. But I will say this, like Richard is a very, very, very good teacher of using a camera. Your tutelage was quite expert. I think if you ever wanted to open a videography school, I think it would be first rate. Because you know
the Barrel School of Video.
I'm very good at explaining things and kind of in a really great way that made me.
I was put forward for a teaching job. Switching film, but I, at summer school, but I wasn't available at the time. I had a freelance on, which is a shame. So I would have really loved to have done that, actually.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Very kind. Very kind. Right. So Zuber chats. I'll start with Mark because he's coming first. That's the logical thing. Mark Flanagan, $5, $5 US American dollars. Directed to you, Duncan. How would you describe Pleasance's career? A lot of bad movies and some classics. Significant career or just a busy one?
How would I describe it? Better than mine. Would be my first.
Don't be daft.
So far, I mean, dude had some incredible. I mean, he kind of crossed that divide, I suppose, from the kind of old guard to the what I guess you would call the new guard. I mean, the 70s brought about a lot of new ways of making movies, and he obviously straddled both of those and managed to have, I think he managed to kind of do the thing that Michael Caine talks about a lot, which is the kind of having the career coming back as, he sort of slotted in at each level of his age. I don't know if it's a bald man thing, but it seems to be where you just don't age, therefore, visually. Yes.
Yeah, motherfucker.
Exactly. So I think, you say a lot of bad movies. I mean, I haven't seen all of his movies, so I couldn't really comment on that. I think a significant career. He certainly hit a lot of very cultural moments and touchstones with his film. So I'd say significant, yes.
I think, as you've kind of touched on, I think the thing with Donald Pleasance is, much like someone like Brian Cox, and I always call him the proper Brian Cox because you know what I mean.
Yeah.
He worked from the classical era, and I think when I was a kid, because of Eddie Izzard and The Great Escape. It was like, oh, Donald Pleasance from The Great Escape. And it's only when I got a bit older and realised, oh, yeah, fuck, he was the Doctor in Halloween and stuff. He crossed over from that old school into the kind of new school stuff and very much crossed over into working with those new Hollywood directors, those Californians, i.e. George Lucas on THX and John Carpenter on this, John Carpenter on Escape from New York, John Carpenter on Prince of Darkness. And he carried over. And I think it's very easy because people like to sort of, when someone just works constantly and does a lot of shit, people kind of like to view that as a failure as an actor. And it's like, you know, that guy worked 3 times a year until he died. Like, people were hiring him.
Oh, dude, yeah. Constantly. I mean, Michael Caine said that a lot. He said, my advice to anyone is always just take all the work you can get because that's how you will hit the big ones. He said, you'll do more shit than you will good films. But he said, the reason why I've done that is, and it's like when Chris Nolan came to me and asked me to read the script for Batman Begins and consider being Alfred, it's like, I realized because he said, like, when he bristled at the fact that, like, his agent started sending him stuff. I can't remember which script it was he was talking about in particular, but he said, got sent a script and kind of turned around to his agent and said, I can't play that. And it, referring to the lead role, who was a sort of young man, you know, a young protagonist. And the agent went, no, it's for the dad role. And he went, ah. He sort of went, okay, I get it now. And he embraced that. And then it's like, I think he said he had another sort of awakening when Chris Nolan came around. And he said that, you know, there are moments in his career where he had a sort of renaissance. And you only do that by just saying yes. Say yes to as much as you can. And I think, I think that's admirable. And I think Donald Pleasance had that, you know, and it's like, and you're right, because the new guard who are coming up and want to put the people in their films that they watched when they were younger are going to want you in their film. And that's exactly what happened. And I think the same thing happened with Donald Pleasance. And like, how can you not want more Donald Pleasance in the world? That's what I say. He's a pleasant presence.
Oh my God. She sells seashells.
Yeah, rubber baby buggy bumpers.
Yeah. He's so like, because again, they kind of foreground him more in the sequels because, you know, Jamie Lee Curtis only did, well, she did one. They did another one. They did another one. They did three. But, you know, he carried it up until more or less to his death. I think he died in 1995. And I think The Curse of Michael Myers was possibly 95, unless he died a little bit after. Mm. And he's great in them. So the characters, Dr. Loomis, like, I think he gets set on fire. So he gets burned. He also has a stroke. So the character really evolves in terms of his physicality and his physical capability. And he really sells it. He's fucking brilliant.
Yeah.
And it's just like, I don't care that he's a load of shit. I mean, look at the man go. He's an incredible actor. And I love this stuff here. This, I think this is the scene where the policeman and Loomis are in the Myers house. And it's all chiaroscuro, dark, inky blacks. And then those little bits of twilight blue and the kind of key lighting. It's just beautiful. And
so he's what's happening now for you?
No, it's finished. It's just
Okay, good.
Right, we need to get onto Robert. I'm so sorry, Robert. This is £5 from Robert. Welcome, thank you very much. He says, I don't think he's come here before. Long time listener, first time caller. My question is, who would win in a fight between Michael Jason Jaws and the shark off of Jaws and Herbie? So we've got Michael Jason Jaws and then the shark off of Jaws and Herbie. Herbie can exist underwater. I think, just to get this out of the way, I think the twosome's easiest one to resolve, Duncan, first, if I could just throw in my two bits. I think Jaws would perhaps try to eat Herbie and choke on a large piece of automobile. That having said, in Jaws, the smaller shark does have a license plate, but it is just a license plate. I don't consider that evidence that the smaller shark ate an entire car and only failed to digest a license plate.
Okay, so that sort of takes Jaws out of the running, and I guess Herbie as well, which leaves Michael and Jason. So it's really, the question is, it's a cryptic one. It's much like doing the crossword. Who would win between Michael and Jason? Crossword. And I guess, well, I don't know.
Well, Michael, Jason, and Jaws, I think, is a separate fight.
Yeah.
Well, this is the thing, because original Jason is just a ripoff of Michael, really. It's just a guy. And then, but then he becomes a zombie quite far in. I think like part six, he becomes a zombie. And it's like, is it zombie Jason? Or is it cyborg Jason from Jason X, Uber Jason? You know, hard to tell. I did read this week that apparently there are some quite serious talks about Pinhead versus Michael Myers.
Right.
And I know, and it's something that got traction after Freddy vs. Jason, and it was supposedly going to be written by Clive Barker and directed by John Carpenter, and they were both approached and had discussions, and Clive Barker's talked about it.
Clive Barker's supposed to have done a remake of Hellraiser a million times over by now, and it's like, you know, I hear interviews with him, and he's like, he's starting to sound like the guy from South. I was like, oh, come get some. Like, I mean, I don't wish to make light of the man's, you know, clear
declining health.
Seems that way. But he seems more preoccupied with his, how can I put this, penis art than, which by all accounts is terrific. And good for him. But I mean, that just seems like dead in the water. It just seems like he cannot seem to reach a kind of, I don't know, like a conclusion on all of it. And it's just like, stop seeing it as this high art thing. It isn't. It's just a weird, I mean, don't get me wrong, of all of them, I think Hellraiser has the most sort of highfalutin, high concept. You know, it has this intangible...
It's got its whole kind of psychosexual thing, I think.
Yeah.
Because this has kind of that discreet misogyny, sexual frustration stuff, but it's fairly discreet compared to Hellraiser, which is about kinky fetish monsters, you know. Whereas this is like, well, Michael seems to punish sex. He seems to be perhaps asexual himself. Like it's, but it's never sort of like, look at me, I'm made out of leather and chains, which is kind of... you know, it's all about the pleasure pain boundary and stuff. And Clive Barker was all about sex. Like,
oh, God, clearly, yeah, he still is, by all accounts. Good for you. I don't say that as a dig or anything like that. I mean, good for him. I'm, you know, he's one of those people. Look, he's a Brit who done well in Hollywood and lives, I think he lives in California.
California.
Sells pictures of ducks. So good for him.
Pictures of ducks. I think Gary and Mob went to his house.
Yeah, someone did an interview with him at his house, and he said, yeah, it was wall to wall ducks. but the man likes a duck. What can I say? Yeah, good for him.
Fair play to him.
I like
fair
mine. Him, yeah. I'm not, you know, not mad about everyone else's. But
I love that you felt the need to qualify. The Howard Hawks thing is on the screen. And because Howard Hawks is someone that John Carpenter really idolized, and putting John Carpenter's whatever on top of a film was something he took from Howard Hawks. And you know, they copy that The Thing title sequence color for the remake, which is really wonderful. The kind of original film adaptation of Who Goes There is about a killer vegetable. The one set on the Trans-Siberian Express is about the thing has possessed a sort of the missing link that they've discovered frozen in the ice, and they're taking back to England for study.
Wow. Okay.
Man, it's fucking rad. It was really good. We slung it on, like got off the stream, and Ivan was like, we should chuck that on. It's like, yeah, sound. Cause it was on YouTube. Fucking great. Horror Express, Adrian Mendoza.
Yeah.
I do generally like Jamie Lee Curtis is a fucking treasure, right? Like, sure. she's just the best. Like, I just love, I love her in anything. She's just good. She's always good in anything you see her in, even if it's a bit of a shitty film. And I liked how kind of, she's not exactly the matriarch in Knives Out, but she's that slightly kind of waspy, witchy kind of lady in it, which I dug. She seems to be sort
she's
of,
always the kind of, she's the palate cleansing character. Usually she's the one who's sort of like, oh, for God's sakes, you know, and cuts through stuff. I mean, not in this, but I mean, in, you know, in a lot of her films, she's the kind of down to earth, very much the kind of protagonist-y type role. I mean, it's, you know, it's interesting, you know, something like True Lies again is like, is really her story, and it's really her, it's her awakening more than it is anyone else, you know. It's, I think that film really is her film, and I'm sure Cameron designed it that way, you know, that's deliberate.
Matt, she's amazing in that.
Yeah,
just like her comic chops in that are off the scale. She's God, so yeah. So good.
When you think what she's asked to do in that film, there's all the different levels of the character, but then it's like there's stunts. Didn't she do the stunt when she gets pulled out of the car by the helicopter?
I believe so, yeah. When it, like,
well, she hung off the helicopter. She didn't do the bit where she gets pulled out of the sunroof.
We pulled out, yeah.
Yeah.
She hung off the thing.
That's so cool, man.
We've got Ivan in the chat.
Hey!
Ivan who's sat below me, not in a sex way, he's on the sofa downstairs.
Not in a sex way. Well, you did roll. You did expose your calves. So
I it's think... true. I did do that. That's true fact. Everyone's still talking about sharks in the comments, which is great. I snuck a kind of one, not single frame, but a very small frame gag in the Night of the Living Dead video on the kind of second pass when I was editing, because their version of Barbara in that film is very similar visually to Jamie Lee Curtis in True Lies.
Mm.
How she starts, and they both start in one place and go to another, so they end up looking similar by the end. You know, they go from kind of dowdy secretary to kind of badass, and it's the same haircut and the round glasses and all that stuff. And I needed a quick picture of that, which is really hard to find. Now, I don't know what the wife is like in La Totale, which is the French version of True Lies, the original. But I Googled like Jamie Lee Curtis in True Lies, and all you can find is the incredibly amazing pole dancing scene or the sexy scene. But there are no pictures of Helen Tasker pre-transformation. It was like the fourth page.
Oh, for God's
sake. And I was like, as much as I love wading through these, which is fine, I really need like, just a picture. Like,
enough already.
And, it was like this super low resolution, and it's the internet going like, well, yes, you look like that in that film for a bit, I guess.
It's like, it'd be taken from some website. It'd be like glassesinmovies.com.
Yes.
It's like identifying the frames and the lens type.
Yes. I think I put a little note saying how difficult that was and thanks onanists on the screen in the video, which nobody seems to have noticed. So rapt they were with my commentary.
That's it. That's it.
Yeah. Mark Flanagan, guys, do you have much of a feeling for Hammer or Amicus? Too old fashioned, perhaps. I've never got on with Hammer or Amicus, and it's one of those things as a British person you're supposed to. I've never really got it, if I'm honest.
I thought when we did Kenneth, those of you who have seen that, Stephen, who played the Goblin in that, he is very much into that kind of Hammer ephemera and those movies and that kind of era of film. And he got us watching things like Dr. Fibes and Blackula and all that stuff. And I don't get it either. I certainly don't find it scary. I just find it largely quite tedious. And I think that's just because I'm of a certain age and what have you, but I just didn't. I do.
Yeah. And I'm going to put that out there. I think the problem was I was spoiled, because I remember watching this when I was little. I was spoiled by things like this.
Yeah.
And then when you go to see a Hammer movie, they're very theatrical and kind of slow burn. And it's like, oh, there's horror. Oh, a horror film's on. But you're so used to sort of like, is a man going to stab a teenage girl in the face? No.
Yeah.
Someone's going to put a curse on someone's dog, which makes them be ill for the whole film and then slowly die at the end or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, they're very, very important. And, you know, the whole Christopher Lee and Peter Cushing thing is in there. They've got their versions of Sherlock Holmes. They've got their version of Dracula. They've got their version of Frankenstein. You know, all that stuff. But I just can't watch them particularly with much. So when it seems that Horror Express, which I will talk about again. I hope Ivan's still here to hear about Horror Express. Apparently it's some of the most screen time that they have together on the screen in a film, Lee and Cushing, because quite often they were in the same film, but not necessarily.
But not of the same film.
And I was a bit like, oh God, this isn't going to be like a Hammer film, is it? Because I find those quite dreary. Yeah. And it wasn't. And so that's great. I feel sacrilege to say. It's a really bad thing to say. I don't feel good about saying that ever. But I've just never got on with them. And I put them in a similar bracket to almost like Carry On.
Yeah.
It's like a whole era of British cinema that I just don't get.
Yeah, it's never really been my thing. Brad Watson's in the house. Woo-hoo!
Brad! Whoop, whoop, whoop. Well, a Halloween movie. Brad says he might have seen this.
Roberto Watson.
There he is.
Well, that is your middle name.
Well, is Hallows Eve still on Netflix?
No.
Oh, boo, fuck. Everybody cancel your Netflix subscription. It's the only reason I had it. That and Star Trek. It's the only reason I had it. Oh, that's rubbish. Okay, well...
Bull fucking hole.
Anyway, Brad's got new shit coming out.
But he does.
If you can watch Brad's Carpenter-influenced horror film, Hallows Eve, starring one Duncan Casey.
And a number of other players.
Mainly you, mostly
but
you.
Mainly
it's all
me.
Him.
It's all about me. No. Yeah, man. No, it's... that's full of Carpenter influences. It's got stuff from the shots inspired by The Thing. This, obviously.
Is it one of the streets named after Haddonfield or something?
Yes. I only know that because my character says Haddonfield Road. That's how I know.
Laurie strode down Haddonfield Road on Halloween. Do you like
Toad.
Captain Kirk masks?
You failed to rhyme. Laurie strode down the road and stood on a toad.
Failed to rhyme, my darling. everyone's,
she dropped a load in the toilet. I mean poo.
I'm talking about defecation.
Hi, Brad. Hi, Brad. Hi, Brow.
Right. Let's. Horror Express. I'm just going to go with some more Horror Express.
Yeah, okay.
From Carl Goddard, who patron, it comes to all the streams. Carl's like a bank of knowledge. I always love that he's got this like on point trivia. He's like the Watcher from the Marvel comics. Horror Express was filmed just after Cushing's wife died, and he really didn't want to do it. Lee had to talk him into traveling to the location and looked after him throughout filming. That is awful because they ever had a really tight friend, a really sweet friendship. Also, because like watching it as well, and you always forget this because if you see Christopher Lee next to Peter Cushing, Peter Cushing looks tiny. Peter Cushing was more than 6 foot; he was tall, and Christopher Lee was just like 9 foot tall, so he just makes him look like really small.
Christopher Lee,
but yeah, they had a really sweet kind of friendship. Those
Brad says Richard, the references in Hallows Eve are way less subtle.
I don't believe it for a minute, Brad. I don't believe it. I just have a quick check of what's cracking. 161. Shit, guys. Welcome. I guess we're seasonally appropriate. It's big numbers for us.
Yeah.
Unpopular channel that we are. See, I quite like this because Michael's kind of obscured behind all the kind of vapor on the screen. So nice, you see him, but you don't see him. Because I think that is this is the often talked about thing, that it's a Captain Kirk mask.
Yeah.
With the kind of eyes cut out and then spray painted white. And it's really enduring image for something that's just come off the shelf. It's kind of, it's funny that, because it's the same, I know it was a sack initially, and then it becomes a hockey mask in Jason, you know, Friday 3. But again, it's another off the shelf thing. I mean, that might be a bit more bespoke. But these kind of off-the-shelf things becoming icons is really interesting. Because maybe it's the horror of everyday objects. And a hockey mask isn't an everyday object. A spray-painted white Captain Kirk mask is not an everyday object that I'm aware of.
Well, I suppose it's the reappropriation of something. And also to hide the face, you know, to be the faceless killer. I think the hockey mask works less well. I think, and maybe because this did it first, but I think, you know, it's the sort of the fact that it's pale, it's just dead, it's got dead eyes, there's no eyes, it's got this blank expression.
It's like a mannequin, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's like a kind of mannequin shape, which is...
He's in a boiler suit, and it's really, you know... And it has become iconic, and it's kind of one of those things where you go, like, well, this is... Again, it's that necessity being the mother of invention. It's, you know, when you're limited in what you can do. Because I gather it was a very last minute thing. Someone just ran out and grabbed it, and that's, you know,
that's a hell of a fucking, that's big dick energy to just not have your mask ready and just go like, fuck it, costume shop. You know, Brad says he's cutting beetroot right now. His hands look appropriately bloody. Spooky beetroot.
Oh, hotel.
Oh God. So I really like the hockey mask, by the way. So part three is when he takes the mask, I'm pretty certain. And that's kind of stuck. And I do like it, but I get what you mean. It's less effective. But to me, it's a signifier of trashy horror. So I'm sort of like, ooh.
Oh, yeah, there's nothing wrong with it. I suppose I just mean it's kind of...
I get it's not as effective. I don't think it's as effective at all. See, look, I love the... It's not very subtle, but Carpenter playing homage to his B-movie roots. And then this is like the watching of television then gets done in Scream... So then in Halloween H20 or H20, they watch Scream, but then in Scream 2, I think it sort of becomes cyclical and stops making sense.
Did it ever start?
But I've never got Scream. Did we talk about this last
week? Yeah, I haven't either.
I've never got it. I mean, like, no, actually, here's the problem. I do get it. I just don't like it.
Well, yeah,
like, I get it, but it's not that interesting to me.
I'm assuming you probably had the same thing as I did, which is your your, you know, 14-year-old, 15-year-old peers running up to you and going,
No, you don't get it. You don't understand because it references other films in the film. It's knowing, okay? It's ironic. It's like, yeah,
just because you say you're doing the thing doesn't make it clever. That's what bothered me about Last Jedi. It's just it repeatedly tells you how clever it is. And it's like, this should be self-evident. You shouldn't need to tell me. Because it's like the opening scene of Scream. This is like I'm in a horror film. Blah. That's how that you could have done that in 2 seconds and saved us all a lot of effort. You do see the Fonz getting his guts torn out, though, so that, or having had his guts torn out. So there's that, I suppose.
Right.
Not that I've got it in for the Fonz. It's just quite a funny image. So I never got that. I did just watch, well, I rewatched Children, The People Under the Stairs last night. Have you seen that, the Wes Craven film, The People Under the Stairs with Ving Rhames?
No.
Cool movie. Good movie. Cool movie. It's 1991. It's something, it was a favourite of my brother and I, because it's totally bananas. It's like this bananas gonzo horror comedy thing about this kind of incestuous couple who want to have a family, so they keep kidnapping boys, and every time they do something wrong, see no evil, hear no evil, speak no evil, they'll cut their ears off or their eyes out, their tongues off, and shove them in the basement and feed them human meat. And the dad of the family, one of them's gone missing and is running around in the walls, and he hunts him wearing a gimp suit with a shotgun. And it's all kind of slyly about gentrification and stuff like that, and sort of that era of America. It's a really funny, good, fun film. And it's like, really good, funny, fun, good Wes Craven. Just kind of like, I've seen horror films, which is Scream 4 times, a 5th time in a TV series, apparently.
True.
You know, I just don't get it. Though I think the ghost face. Sorry, kid. I'll shut up in a minute. The ghost face mask from Scream, which is a cool look. That is a pre-existing character as well, I think.
Is it?
That is a thing. I believe the ghost face is a thing from another thing.
It always just struck me as something they were trying to engineer. It never really, you know, because it was like, oh, they all have masks, so here's one that's scary, and it looks like the Scream painting. You know, it's the.
Yeah, it does. It looks like the Munch painting. Yeah, absolutely. I do think it's a cool look. I remember I used to have that mask. I didn't like the film, but I liked the mask. Used to glow in the dark as well. I do kind of feel like, because the premise of Scream has to be every time someone else's ghost face. 4 times. It's like, really? Like, because there's no, like, you have to engineer a link between them and Sydney, what's her name, every time. You have to engineer a link every time. They have to have a reason every time. And I find that really fucking tedious.
Yeah.
Fuck you, Scream and Dead Wes Craven. Fuck, no, not really. I don't mean that.
Doug Wanacott asked me a question. I just wanted to, he said the US. Oh, he didn't ask me a question. Sorry, he said the US Blu-ray of The Woman in Black looks like they've accidentally put a picture of me on the cover instead of Daniel Radcliffe.
People do compare to Daniel Radcliffe sometimes.
I do get that. I hear that.
You're more handsome than him.
Oh, you're too kind. I don't know about that. But if they ever want to cast his older brother, I'm in there.
People think when they say I look like Donald Pleasance, they're being rude to me, but they're not, because I think that's cool.
That is cool. He's a handsome man. He's a handsome man.
And I can tell you this for nothing. He's a handsome and very fucking hot man. And not in a sex way. I'm talking about tweed under a raincoat. That's what I'm talking about.
Sweaty man.
A sweaty man and a tweed tie. Well, tartar, naturally. It's quite nice.
Yeah, I find that those sort of wool ties act like a freaking scarf, though. Like, they're pretty miserable.
It goes quite well with my kilt. As I wore this tie to your wedding, actually.
Nice.
Because it matched my kilt. Because I wore my kilt to your wedding.
It was very cool.
Because I tell you what, at the height of summer, no better way to beat Betty Swallocks in a kilt. Anyway, I've got a film degree. I like how they point the camera at the lady when she's looking out the window. What do you think?
Rob Myers wrote something that tickled me, but he wrote a comment that said hashtag clever, and he wrote another one that said, there, I done a clever.
Hey.
I don't know.
Someone was asking what we think about the Saw film. Something I can't find it at the moment. Any thoughts on Saw?
I think I saw the first one and that was it. And I found that to be quite an underwhelming. I was not whelmed by that film at all. And I found it quite dull.
I thought it was a decent enough one and done.
Yeah. That's what I can't remember what it was about. One and done. The end pissed me off and I can't remember why. And I just went, gimmick, go away. And then it spawned.
That's the thing. and they've had to bend over backwards to go, oh, that one, the seventh one set before the ninth one, but after the second one, because Jigsaw Bum, or whatever he's called, his son's cousin was trained to be him first, but then he went to Japan afterwards, but then he read on Wikipedia that he hadn't died yet, so he came back to life and taught his son how to do it. Then he had a son, but he died, so he showed it to his wife, and that saw 12. It's like, what? No, it's a man who puts people's dicks in padlocks or whatever, and ties the upper end to a dog with loads of sausages chasing a van, or I don't know, that's what happens in Saw, isn't it? I don't fucking know.
Basically, yeah. You're just waiting. You want the thing with Sora is it's like the secret, I suppose, is that you're wanting the villain to win because you kind of want to see the horrific
because they're bad
thing
people
happen.
Yeah,
and it's like, you know, he fiddled donkeys or something, and that's why he's in there. And
fiddled donkeys,
yeah, you know. And
oh, and it's monkey poor punishment is now this donkey will fiddle you.
Yeah,
but its hooves have been replaced with hot screwdrivers.
He's going to bum you, like, and then bummed by a donkey with the hot screwdrivers fast.
And also, its head's a padlock.
Yeah.
The combination is your mum's birthday.
The Phillips head. I'm not a monster. It's
cross nose. If you don't want to use a brand.
They don't all belong to my dad.
Well, I'm just going to segue here so we can, I feel, disappoint poor Sam Montgomery, because Sam's asking £2 super chat. Thank you very much, Sam. Have you watched Hereditary? Heard mixed things. Hereditary is one of these horror movies of the last few years, supposed to be very good.
Asking us that, don't they? Yeah.
Well, I think I'm going to try and watch it this season. I think that's on Ivan and I's list, I believe, of things. No, I have not, Sam, I'm afraid. I wish I had done. Because I've heard that, but Sam says mixed things. So there you go.
I'm looking it up now, just so that I'm aware.
I sure love having sex and smoking cigarettes. Me too. Let's never get stabbed.
It's got Gabriel Byrne and
Tony Collette, mate. Give me a fucking cigarette.
Yeah.
I'm Tony Collette. My name's Muriel's Wedding, and I want to smoke.
It's something about a boy. Yeah.
Put it in my clacker.
Oh, my God.
Oh, dear. Why? You know.
Yeah.
I spent a lot of time lighting this scene. I dressed up.
Yeah.
I'm talking
sorry,
about
Sam.
Tony Collette's clacker. Everyone's just like, is there a button to take your super chat back? Where's that button?
Yeah, there should be.
Joe Zilla says, some days you fiddle the donkey and some days the donkey fiddles you.
And some days it's it repairs your head gasket for you.
because difficult for a donkey to rotate and therefore achieve torque. Not sure do donkeys have
torsion. It's difficult for a donkey to achieve with
like and donkey. Of course a hot screwdriver, it could only touch certain screws. Yeah, it could cause damage to any existing fittings, could of course transfer heat by contact and then melt any plastic housing.
That's true. Yeah, it would have to be only metal screws, brass screw. That's where he pins the guy to the fridge, right?
Yes, this is the one, really. This is the bit. I watched this sleepover at my house, actually. We had one of my mates over, and it was like, oh yeah, Halloween's on. It like it, so you know what I mean, like we pretended to fall asleep and then put the TV on when it's like, and this was the scene where it was scary. It was kind of like, yeah, it had an air of menace, but this was where kind of things viscerally happened. I was just kind of like, oh my God, that lad's been stuck to the fridge. Also just the whole thing of it's been so endlessly done now, but like Laurie hiding in the cupboard from Michael. Yeah. Like that's really relatable, particularly as a kid, because you know, hide under the bed, hide in the cupboard, like whatever.
The I mean, that I suppose that speaks to the kind of idea that he's a bit superhuman, because it would take immense strength to lift a man by his neck with one hand and stab him in so hard that it goes through him into a cupboard to the cupboard.
It's got to be a very, very big knife, is there?
Yeah.
Whoa, I'm a ghost.
But also, the idea that wouldn't the guy like go all limp and fall off the knife, probably.
I mean, one of those movie things, isn't it, that looks cool when you do it. It's like when at the end of Commando he throws the pipe through Bennett. It's kind of like, because then there's like a big inside that pipe, there must be a big kind of tube of Bennett meat with a chainmail seal either side of
it. Well, because doesn't steam out. Comes out of it. So in theory, it should shoot him in the face with a bit of a chunk
this
of Bennett.
Big bit of guts just goes.
Yeah. A chunk of Bennett, which was then what Matrix's book was all about, talking about his adventures in Val Verde.
It's a last minute attempt to try and preserve the fiction of our YouTube channel. That's long since fallen by the wayside.
Yep.
So I love it, because this Michael presumably got a little bit of string to hold the glasses on, or a bit of blue tack.
Yeah.
Isn't this sheet like over his mask?
Yeah, exactly. He says, so the guy must have had just a massive head. Are you okay? Are you okay? I can hear your tits.
I can hear your tits. Oh dear. It's a funny joke. Annie, are you okay? Are you okay, Annie?
Annie, get your gun.
She's just having her sexing.
I mean, that's another thing about the Michael Myers mask that it differentiates is his whole head. It covers his whole head, whereas like Jason's one is just his face. And then it increasingly seems that you have to do this rotting thing that it's attached to.
Because when I did Friday 3 last week,
I just had this thing where it's like, hello, like if someone dubbed like Bricktop over Michael Myers at that point, I think that would work really well.
Cunt.
Who is this? Johnny Franks, I know him. Over from flats in Bow. You syntaxicated fuck pig. Sorry, I'm so sorry.
Nothing I was going to say matters.
No, it did. Right. I was just
no, I don't even remember what I was on. No, that was better. No. That's better than whatever I had. So you see, I actually want some Venetian blinds to do lighting with. They're a really useful thing to have. I've used them before.
We have them.
Yeah, I don't have any now. Well, I wanted some portable. I've got some. Some I would literally keep in my kit though, because it's a really nice effect. I did it on Icon. I did a whole.
We literally had for the longest time, because we have this bay window in our living room that for the longest time. So we ordered up some blinds to go in it, like custom ones. But we ran into, so we put the first one up, which is a ball light, because basically we're screwing into plasterboard and that is a pain in the ass. And then we went to put the other ones up and then hit on the kind of living room side, just what are they called? My head is not working properly. Steel, basically. There's a steel
house. There was house there.
There was house, basically, yeah. It's whatever they're called. And so for the longest time, we were thwarted. I was trying to come up with ideas of like how to drill into the steel and blah, blah, blah. And then in the end, we just paid two guys to come round. We paid them like 50 quid and they just came and shot like these, they're bolts for like, or screws, types of bolt screw things that are designed for like roofing. So they literally are designed to just be, you drill to it and then you just literally RSJ, thanks Dad, you literally fire these things into the steel and they just kind of
supporting joist.
Yes, indeed. So rolled steel joist for anyone who likes a good portmanteau.
Keep it together.
They're not working. You know what I mean. They did that anyway. My point was, for the longest time we've had a bunch of Venetian blinds that you could have borrowed. That's it. That's the story. It's a boring story about how we put up, how we thwarted the attempts of an RSJ to stop us putting up our.
I'm gonna go now.
It's like, because you're boring.
The buff. This is the cookie I made earlier.
It's amazing.
So I can give myself a really great kind of across the face, but it's for the background. So when Ellie sent the thing, like I said earlier, the box came, and I've wanted to do a kind of Venetian style lighting on a stream for ages, and I thought, you know what, today's the day, because I need to relax, and weirdly I do relax by creating lighting schemes. I just find it very fun and a relaxing. So that's a box that I took a craft knife to. I've been taping up to get my kind of Venetian look in the background, which I'm thinking about, I want to shoot my DC cab video maybe tomorrow, so I'm thinking about just leaving this up, sleeping with my room like this, and then
waking up.
And I did a video. There's a video on Patreon. Went up today. Yes, it did. No, mother. I did a video about it on Patreon. There's a, like a 10 or 12 minute video on Patreon where I did a kind of walkthrough of doing this lighting scheme today.
That's another Simpsons thing, is it? Because honestly, the thing for me of like talking about Vietnam experiences whilst lit with the slats from a Venetian blind is basically what Skinner does in that.
Yes.
But where he keeps turning away and he's like, like when they kept me in that camp, you know, and he just keeps turning around. And yeah, and I had that very discussion, not to name drop, with George Clooney. So there you go. What's that thing?
Yeah, I'm George Clooney. I like Venetian blinds. Yeah. Oh, Mr. Clooney.
No, not about Venetian blinds, but about just being like being in that generation of people referencing things that were being referenced by the people not actually knowing what the source thing was. Because I was doing Gomer Pyle, but without kind of realizing it.
And yeah, because like, we never got Hogan's Heroes, did we?
And I was just like, God zooks or whatever. And he was just like, because we were supposed to be American troops in Monuments Men. I was like, you know, all that sort of stuff. And he goes, he was like, Gomer Pyle, right? And I was like, I've probably...
Yeah, whatever, dickhead. Shit, American dickhead. Whatever.
No, I obviously was internally pissing myself with...
I'd love if you'd just been out-of-handedly rude for no reason.
No,
you
no,
fucking
I was just like,
prick.
Fuck, I'm having a conversation here, you rude bastard.
I'm having a conversation, you handsome cunt.
Yeah, no. It was him and Hugh Bonneville were doing it. It was a scene where they were walking through... And I just said, yeah, I'll be honest, I never saw it. I don't think we got it here, but I was just like, that's the Simpsons thing. I said, I just saw it on the Simpsons, like so much stuff. And he was like, ah, ha, ha, ha. And then Hugh Bonneville also went, ha, 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 ha. And then it was.
I too like laughing at things. He's never laughed at a thing in his life.
You must be a god. And then they went back to their ones. That's my idea.
To me, originally it was Full Metal Jacket.
Oh right, yeah.
Because he calls Vincent D'Onofrio Private Pyle, and to me that was, I guess that's what Private Pyle means. Until I got secondhand Hogan's Heroes references through The Simpsons. I suppose people just going like, "What's this got to do with Halloween?"
Yeah, true. For me, the scariest thing, or the shot for me that stood out from this film. When I first saw it is when she is cowering in the corner and his mask just comes into, you know, he just, obviously just comes into
light. I think the things of him, there's a lot of emergence for Michael. Yeah. And because he's silent, that's what makes that kind of creepy. Is it because even if it's kind of silly, it's fun to joke about it. But like him just going behind the hedge is actually really like, okay, what's this?
But the thing is,
why is he doing that?
In order for him to not be there when the other one comes around the corner, he must have just stepped back and then legged it down that path.
Did you see that someone did a video like that recently? Did you see it? It went viral. It's Michael Myers, like, you know, when they're running away and he's walking behind them and they turn a corner and it cuts to him going, just like running around, jumping over a fence, leaping over a car, just going like, when he gets over the other side, because he has to like, what you don't see is running all the way around.
No. Someone did that, I think, with Batman from like The Dark Knight and stuff, where he's like, you know, he's in the vault with Gordon and Gordon turns around and he's gone, but then they added like a CGI Batman sort of going like running out of the vault because it's such broad daylight.
It's really well lit.
And it's like he couldn't have just disappeared anywhere because he's in a bank vault. But like,
oh man, yes, it's silly, but you know, see this, look at this, I love this stuff. It's kind of like the, well, obviously the gravestone and everything, but just the lighting with the pumpkin there. You know, it's just so nicely put together. So if you watch it, so obviously,
Who Framed Roger Rabbit? Oh no, not that shot. Sorry, go on.
Okay. Oh, so, well, Who Framed Roger Rabbit? Kundi, that. Okay, there you go.
Is it here?
But, no. Yeah. Oh no, it's the body that swings out. I thought it was the face that goes. No. In Who Framed Roger Rabbit, Dean Kundi gets to go full noir because they're taking the piss out of noir, because this is very kind of noir-ish with all the kind of blacks. And I've always associated John Carpenter's cinematography with that. Really inky black nighttime look, like whoever's his DP, you know, when they collaborate, like his films, I always think of that really ink, those inky blacks, and Escape from New York and this, because the thing's very blue, as we discussed when we watched it But this is one where it's, yeah, those really kind of, there you go, it was there. His face just comes out the door.
Horrible.
I like that POV as well of the spiral
going down the stairs.
Down the stairs, yeah.
Yeah, it's hard to do that because it has a visceral quality to it, but it is what that you could see that because you obviously can't throw a camera off the top, so it can't fall at the right speed, if that makes sense. Right. And it also wouldn't look like it was anyway, because if you actually dropped it off, it would look ridiculous and incomprehensible. So it's kind of like
it's because like the solution now would be like you could drop a GoPro, and it's like, yeah, but a GoPro is like a large dice; it would just go.
I know. Well, I think because it's focusing on the stairs, it's like literally the stairs are coming up at you, and it's like that's what makes it work. Because
the best thing to do is to get a live pig, attach enough weight to make it the same weight as your principal actor, put a GoPro on that, and throw that off a balcony.
That's it. You've got it. You went to film school, my son.
I did. That's what they taught us on the first day. It's so they give you just loads of bags of flour, a pig, some gaffer tape, a GoPro, and some stairs, and go solve this. And then if you do it, you don't have to go to any more classes for 3 years, and they just give you a degree at the end.
Yeah, you go straight to Hollywood.
You go straight to Hollywood, like I did.
Brad really says Dean Cundey was the man. I quite agree. Brad might have worked with him, I don't know.
No, possibly, yeah. I don't know. But yeah, Cundey, man, he was amazing. I think when I watched, I keep talking about DC Cab because I've got the video coming, it's on my mind. I think when I was like really pissed one night, and I was like, Brad, have you seen DC Cab? And I think he was just minding his own business, and I can't remember if he had or not because I was quite drunk. Yeah. And by the time he answered, we'd put Gremlins 2 on. And I was like, no, I want your Gremlins 2! Again, quite drunk.
I would just like to emphasize, I was very drunk.
Very, very.
Very drunk.
Poor Brad and my drunken text messages.
News.
News. Where's McKay's? There's a donkey here with screwdrivers for hooves.
He's like making a clinking noise as he walks down the street.
He's traveling on some kind of large scale Asterix track.
He's got the voice of Eddie Murphy.
He's got small wire wall brushes to conduct electricity on his feet.
It's getting weird.
What even is this? What is this anymore? No. Oh, God.
Anyway,
Sam Montgomery, John Carpenter with Dean Cundey cinematography can make anything look 10 times more expensive than it was. I mean, Dean Cundey, it's just a look, man. I think because even Jurassic Park, you know, all the high end stuff, because he did a bunch of kind of silly comedies and stuff as well. But you know, he made them look good. Like fucking DC Cab. I'm going to do a review of DC Cab, and 12 people are going to watch it. But if like 3 of those 12 people watch DC Cab, I'll be happy. I could probably get better results by physically threatening people or kidnapping or something. But you know,
the thing is, I mean, the principles of lighting a scene and
I can't do this. Fucking yeah, it's coming off again. Sorry.
Yeah, the principles of filmmaking are the same whether you're making a small or big budget movie. It's just, you know, it's just how much equipment you have to play with, really, and how much time you have to play with.
It's all about. I'm a big advocate. Yeah, if anybody watched the Patreon video of it today, like I've always done things on a kind of DIY basis, as you've just seen from my kind of cookie over there. But I also bought like these A4 black foam boards from Hobbycraft, which are amazing baffles, like for just kind of flagging off lights and stuff. Baffle, they're really good. And then I once bought like these clamps, or the little, you know, the little kind of black clamps I've got for putting up for putting up our backdrops and stuff.
Yeah,
I got those from like a film shop on Amazon for X amount of pounds. I was in Poundland and I saw the exact ones, and I just kind of went, fine, I'm buying 10 packs of those then. Like, they're really good and they cost more on the internet. So yeah. I just bought a fucking loaf of power. Man, if you can fucking blag it. Me and my dad made a camera stabilizer out of kind of metal trunking when I was a teenager, and barbell weights from Sports Direct.
Nice.
Where it's just kind of like my dad used the, it's kind of this trunking that they use on site because my dad was a Sparky. It's a kind of metal kind of trunking you see on walls and stuff. And the junction, so the middle was a kind of T-shaped junction, and he had a machine to thread the piping. So we threaded them. Mm-hmm. Then we put a nut on the bottom for the weights. So you counterbalance the camera. And then on the top, we just had a tripod head. Oh, wow. I sort of put my little tripod, my little camcorder, and that's I was using that rig the night we got held at gunpoint by armed police. Oddly enough, you know that story, don't you? Already, that's a risky Christmas thing. Yeah, I was out carrying this fucking thing with my little camcorder on top of it. So if you could do it cheap if it looks good. I know your man who directed I can't remember the bloody guy's name off my head. Your man who directed Shazam has a YouTube channel.
All
right. He goes on a pony smasher. He's really good, really interesting guy, really funny guy. He's showing about how to make your own dolly track out of Perspex pipes and old rollerblade wheels. He was just like, look, if it fucking works, it works. And he just demoed the kind of fake. Well, it's not fake. It's a dolly. It's just made out of trunking. And
we had that. I remember they tried that on Kenneth. We had that, but it creaks loads. Like plastic piping creaks when you run a dolly over it. So it's like we used it, I think, 3 times, and they were like, "Nah, this has to go because it's not."
If you're dubbing, there's a few things where if you're dubbing, fine. Yeah. Or if you're, certain things as well, if you're recording sound separately. I've seen people. Well, firstly, filmmaking, really, you should get into the discipline of focusing manually. And this is really annoying because I fucking left my autofocus on and I can't turn it off. So it makes like today is my active hypocrisy. But you know, you should really learn to focus manually because autofocus isn't reliable enough. It's not really what you want to be doing. Perhaps in a documentary setting, you do. Particularly if you're using cine lenses, there's an expectation that you're going to pull focus manually where you can.
Mm.
And I've seen people, I've had footage from people where they've used the autofocus in the camera and they've used like an onboard mic or even one that's on board but still plugged into the mount of the camera externally but technically on board, and it's just like it sounds like Robocop having a wank every time it focuses. And it's like, well, yeah, because you used your in camera sound and you've used your autofocus. I mean, even if you manually focus with the in camera mic, you get that kind of like what this lens in particular, this is like little 50mm Canon, goes when you kind of manual focus it without a focus puller. So you know, it's just all part of it. See, this is fucking, she sells this so well.
Yeah, man.
And also you get that the great thing about Laurie is that she's not a fucking idiot. Like, she's smart, she's likable, and she's smart, and she doesn't just kind of crumble.
She's resourceful. Yeah,
because of course you're going to fucking scream because the nut's trying to kill you. There's nothing wrong with that. But hey, get a fucking coat hanger and stab the cunt in the eye.
Yeah, well, I mean, because as well, like, she's one of those people who's not, I guess, because she's, you could argue this is the, not to get wanky and pretentious, but I'm going to, I suppose it's her lot, like, is that her losing her virginity? Like, is that sex? She just,
that's what, that's,
now is
you'd
she
be stunned
still?
To learn that that's what's discussed around this film in film theory.
Right,
yeah.
Okay, right, there you go.
Yeah, that's been written about as a kind of potential. Carpenter kind of tends to resist that sort of stuff. He tends to sort of say, like, look, I was just telling a story, and what you put into it is what you put into it. I think They Live is one where it's kind of like, yeah, well, obviously we're doing a thing, like, it's about economics, but he's quite often just like, yeah, Romero was the same. He was like, you know, I'm just telling a scary story a lot of the time. And I think the psychosexual side of this is what's read into it quite a lot. And the slasher genre in general is about kind of like, you know, sexual or romantic relationships between genders and groups and stuff like that. So I can't remember, is it Sleepaway Camp where the killer is revealed to be intersex at the end? I think I've never seen Sleepaway Camp. I mean, it's just one I know about. But there's one of the slasher kind of early slasher films where the killer's revealed to be intersex. And I don't really know what they're saying with that.
I'm intersex. Sorry.
Aren't we all, dear?
Okay.
Jack Guidera says, oh, no, I just want to say, actually, just segue. Oh, good segue. We did have someone just say hello. Cody Bartell, hello from Alaska. Listening to you guys. Look. There you go. That's some exotic shit up in there. Look, there's me, but he's still got his coat and that on. Jack Guidera, I hope I said your name correctly, Jack. If you could only watch one Halloween film for the rest of your life, which one would you pick? Bonus points if it's not the original. Duncan's only seen the original with the D ones.
So, right, the new one, yeah.
I would watch Halloween 3, man. Halloween 3 is wicked. Like, if you're telling me I can't watch the original, Halloween 3, and again, should you ever get time to do things ever again, perhaps when your daughter has got a mortgage or something, Halloween 3, really good. Just view it as its own thing, as a kind of standalone horror thing. It's got the Daniel O'Herlihy, the old man from OCP, playing kind of the old man from OCP, actually, because he's like the head of a bad company and stuff.
That's very, when he gets shot there, it's very like, I am being shot.
shot.
Yeah, I forget
shot.
You see his face in this.
Yeah, in this series, actually, you see Michael's face more than you think. Because there's a few times where you see, like, not quite often in silhouette off above, behind and stuff like that. There's one, there's the bit with, I can't remember where it takes place or in a series, but it's, I think it's a flashback to when Michael's a little boy, and then the kind of equivalent of like the mental health parole board want to put him into a minimum security institution and stuff, and Loomis goes to see him, and it's a little blonde boy just sat by the window, and he's like, you fooled them all, Michael, but you didn't fool me. And it's just straight up a kid sat there, you see his face, because it's little boy Michael.
It's a bit like
Halloween 3 is anti-Irish propaganda, says Joseph. I mean, it's kind of, if you'd seen it, the company's called Silver Shamrock. And it contains an earworm of a song, because they're like selling these hypnotized tainted toys and TV adverts to sort of take over the world. And it's happy, happy Halloween, 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 happy, happy Halloween, Silver Shamrock. And it just lives in your head forever. Yeah. And it's essentially London Bridge is falling down, falling down. But it will rent space in your head for all time. So I love all the lighting in this end sequence is so good, because it's mostly blackness, like it's just inky blacks.
Well, it's kind of how it starts as well, isn't it, with the pumpkin just in the dark. It's just images coming out of the dark at you, which Michael does as well, like he just comes out of the dark.
Look, I've tried to go for that with today's overlay. Top left, I've used the poster art of the pumpkin and the stabby hand, and then top right, I found a nice black and white image of Michael. And it was from an article called, like, did you know Halloween is based on a real case? And it's just like, well, it's not, though, is it? I mean, I'm sure a horrible thing happened that was similar that perhaps inspired it, but it's not, though, is it? It's sort of like the way people go, like, do you know how Texas Chainsaw is based on a real case? It's not, though, is it? I mean, it's kind of partially based on Ed Gein, and it's a few different things, but that didn't actually happen. The film's artifice is that it actually happened, but it's not, though, is it? It didn't really happen, though, did it? It's not.
That is British humour summed up in a nutshell.
Snarky cuntitude.
Yeah, like just regressive behaviour to a just ludicrous degree. This kind of let's drag everything down into the mire.
And so proud of it we are.
I know. It's like,
it's not though, is it? You didn't know, did you?
You're a prick though, aren't you?
You are a prick though, aren't you, mate? You didn't know, did you, mate? You're a prick though, aren't you, mate? Oi, Michael, you're a prick, mate. Yeah, you're a prick. I used to know someone, and it was horrible to behold. Like, to actually view it as a thing that was happening was very, very horrible. But when he didn't like someone, or they would do something he didn't like, or say something he didn't like, he would just go, dickhead. And when he spoke again, he'd go, you're a dickhead. And then when the person, you're a dickhead though, aren't you? You're a dickhead. Mate, you're a dickhead. And just keep doing it. It was horrible.
Wow.
But really effective. But we all hated that guy for being that cunt. But it was just, you're a dickhead though. You're a dickhead. It's just like, God, guy? You're awful. It's a lad from my school. It's just like, you're the most, I don't know what became of him. Death, hopefully.
Well, ultimately, yes.
Yes, we are all, as pointed out at the beginning of the stream, going to die.
Yeah.
Death's icy grip will hold us all eventually.
Sort of nihilistic.
Bye! End the stream on the most bummer note ever. Oh, Christ. Well, there you go. This John Carpenter's Halloween. Juan Carpenter. now we're into the latter part of the stream. Long may that continue.
The Church of Latter-day Stream.
The Church of Latter-day Stream. I was going to check that I got my filters on today. Yes. I've been using the noise suppression filter on OBS. I found it rather effective for reducing hiss. Yeah.
Dad sent us another tenor, God bless him. Says a laugh a minute as always, keep it up. I always feel slightly bad because obviously it's jokes about, you know, willies and poo and donkeys with screwdrivers fans. It's not something you thought expect to
it's the donkeys with screwdrivers. I make those kind of jokes with my dad, to be fair.
Oh really?
We make quite my dad's very, very silly. So we've always silly jokes, but we also stray into sort of like poos and wees. But I can sort of cross it because he used to always sort of joke like, oh yeah, when you're gonna have when you're gonna have grandkids, and I would always say things like, well, there might be one running around Japan we don't know about or stuff like that. I would, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And he goes like, what's this? I once said to my mum in front of my dad, and this is one of the things my mum. So what I like to do, as I said before, is just say the rudest possible thing in front of my mum, and if my mum hits me, my dad laughs, and I've done well. And I said to my mum in front of my dad, I haven't got anybody pregnant, not unless they've been wringing out my socks. And she hit me around the head, and my dad just cracked up, and I was like, yeah, I've done today. Just general filth. General filth.
Fair enough.
Well, news.
My dad says they were my jokes long before they were yours.
There you go.
Fair enough.
That's it. That's the voice of the old school right there, telling you.
It is. I use that on my daughter tonight.
Yes. I mean, our comprehension is not quite there yet, but you might as well get started now. I was thinking because you, Philip, and yourself were talking about drunkenness in the 60s, and your dad piped in when you're telling that story, saying it was a Sunday afternoon, nonetheless.
Oh, wow.
I might have told this before, but fuck it. My dad, I think it was called the Rose and Crown. It's now opposite the Fitzwilliam Museum in Cambridge, is the Loch Fyne restaurant. Mm-hmm. I think it used to be called the Rose or the Rose and Crown. And that's where my dad met my mum.
Oh, wow.
Because my mum came down from Scotland to live here, and that's where my mum, yeah. But my dad used to booze there quite a lot, and my dad had a plastic pig, which, if you don't know what that is, it's like a three-wheeled car. So if you're young or foreign, they don't exist anymore. Technically, it has a motorcycle engine, so you only needed a motorcycle license to drive a plastic pig. Did you know that?
Not a Robin Reliant, then. Something else.
Yeah, Robin Reliant, yeah.
I was a Robin Reliant, okay. It's
technically a motorcycle, so you don't need a full driving license.
Yes.
So my dad used to go and get pissed in there, and he lived with his mum and dad in Shelford, and I think the statute of limitations had run out on this, so I don't think he'd get arrested. It's in the 70s. and he would go and get pissed in there, and then go to Trumpton Street, get in it, and drive to Shelford, which is, what, like 3 miles away or something, or 4 miles away? It's a fair old drive.
It's one road, but it's, yeah, it's...
yeah, it's good old... probably about 4 or 5 miles, I think. Yeah. So anyway, my dad did that, and he come rolling out, and he got into his Robin Reliant, and he drove home and he parked it kind of skew on his mum and dad's drive, and then got out, went to bed, woke up to go to work the next day, got in it, started driving back to Cambridge. Then he noticed like an A to Z map on the seat, and he's like, I don't have an A to Z. Then he sort of looked around the car and realised that none of the things were his things, and it was in fact someone else's car, but the key just worked.
Oh my God.
He was just like, oh fuck, I'm like in not my car. And he went back to town, and his car was luckily still there, so he just backed up the car he'd fucked off home in, locked it up, and got in his own car and fucked off to work. Can you imagine? It's unreal. That's how shitty and cheap those cars were. You could just take the key and just get into another one.
That's brilliant. Those were Jeremy Clarkson did a thing on Top Gear before obviously leaving, where he did a thing on Robin Reliant, and it was like basically the joke was every time he tried to take a corner, the damn thing it fell over and he rolled it. He'd put a roll cage in it, and the joke was, oh, they were so unreliable, and he put a roll cage in it and wore a helmet. But then what he was really intending to do was literally every time he took a corner, the whole thing just rolled over on itself. He had to keep pushing it back over and getting in it. They were dangerous.
Oh, Jesus.
Fuck, yeah, they were. Terrible.
Fucking Christ, Jesus.
Because the thing is, if you imagine it pitches into a corner, I think the point was if you were braking into a corner, So in other words, like yeah, if you took the corner too fast and hit the brakes, all the weight shifts to the front and there's nothing on the front corner to resist. So it just basically would flip over if you were unlucky enough. So yeah, there was a...
Of course, great, yeah.
I mean, that's why they don't exist today. Although, you can get the... is it... who makes it? There is one. There's a very, very sort of specialist car manufacturer. Is it Ariel? Ariel, who make the Atom. Anyway, if anyone knows about cars, the Ariel Atom, which was a sort of lightweight made of... looks like scaffolding and bits of old iron, and then it's got like a Toyota engine in the back. But it's
what was it called again? Let me look
Ariel,
it up.
Ariel Atom.
Ariel spelled like the washing up stuff.
I think it's A E R I A L, but it's the. Hang on. No.
Oh, good God! Okay, I see what you're talking about. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so, scaffolding is accurate.
Yes. Yeah. So it's like a kind of kit car. Oh no, it's ARI. Anyway, but they made a trike. Aero trike. Did they? Oh no, they didn't. Well, someone like them made one anyway that had like, but it had the two wheels at the front and one at the back, and that was weird, but went like stink.
Oh, I've seen those weird fucking things. Dan Lyles has just said that he's tweeted at us a poster that he made based on the preamble to the movie.
Oh.
Which I'm going to overlay now for everyone to look at because it's amazing. And if you missed the preamble, it'll make no sense. But, you know, context never stopped Val Verde Broadcasting.
Oh, nice. Oh, that's amazing.
Oh, okay. A noise just happened that I've never heard before. I think on OBS. I'm not sure.
Oh, really?
There you go. I'm a Scandinavian apples and pears.
From the international best-selling trilogy. I love the way he's changed nothing else about it.
It's the Brilliant. Serious look, because that poster, I've seen that before, I know that exists, but that serious look on Craig's face with that caption,
yeah,
is that might be the best thing.
It's like, it's imagine the meeting that went on with Fincher and Craig, like now the title is really key here. And it's just like, imagine all the meetings and all the casting stuff, and then it's like, yeah, I'm a Scandinavian apples and pear. Love it. Love your work, Dan. As always, as I said to people, you know, please go and check Dan Lyles out on the Twitter and on the...
Dan's got a... I tell you what, actually, so Dan's Insta, Dan does a Redbubble store with loads of really cool stuff on it.
Oh, wow,
really
okay.
Kind of,
yeah.
It's kind of in the vein of the kind of Last Exit to Nowhere type stuff, but a bit more not abstract, but just cool. Like he did like, you know, like the North Face, the brand?
Mm-hmm.
But it was says, I think it was the logo was half of the Mandalorian's head and it said like, this is the way.
Nice.
So that's cool as shit. Like, so go check out, go buy some stuff.
Yeah, that is Dan Lyles 78, right? That's...
I believe so. I'm sure Dan, yeah. He's probably a bit embarrassed. Right,
capital
now,
D,
Dan
capital
can...
L, all one word, Dan Lyles 78.
Takes commissions as well, I believe. I have some amazing artwork by Dan because I commissioned a Star Trek one for Ivan, then I got a kind of Richard Judge Jackson versus zombies picture. It chucked in for free, which is amazing. So that's cool. That's cool as fuck. I need to shout out. John and Christina at Alley Cat Graphics. I just bought some stuff off them, and they chucked in a bunch of freebies for me as well because they're diamonds.
Oh, wow.
Hold on, I should probably because it's horror. Themed.
Dan Lyles is the Chernobyl reactor of artwork. If you don't release the pressure, he will keep building and building and building until he just explodes in a cataclysmic event of reverential art.
Exactly.
There you go.
So Alley Cat are not sponsoring us or anything, but they do horror themed. Pins and stickers and stuff. Pins. Lock me in the cellar and feed me pins.
Johnny.
I just bought a bunch of stuff for someone's Christmas, so I'm not going to show that, but I'm going to show the things that got chucked in, which is soon going to decorate my laptop, I think.
Oh.
So we've got, these are neat as fuck. I've got sticker of the thing.
Oh, cool.
Thing logo.
Look at that.
I've got Dr. Logan from Day of the Dead. I've got Day of the Dead from
about zombies.
Day of the Dead. That's upside down. I've got Captain Rhodes from Day of the Dead. They know what I like, clearly. I've got Dr. Tongue from
Day of the Dead.
But then I've got The Thing.
Oh, cool.
Freddy the Thing. Yeah, Freddy Krueger.
Oh, very good.
Freddy Krueger. More The Thing.
Freddy.
There you go.
Krueger.
Freddy. So I got loads of cool shit this week, and I'm going to slap this probably over my laptop.
Very good.
Again, not being sponsored, I just bought some stuff, and they took me a bunch of freebies because of diamonds. We met those guys when we first went to Comic-Con together.
I do. I remember, yes. Yeah, remember? Yeah, very sweet. Very
and John came to fix it in post at the Kung Fu place as well. So you go.
Kung Fu.
Cool stuff. Kung Fuck Are You.
Welcome to Kung Fuck You.
I like to say
fucks you.
Rob Myers, there's a bub behind Captain Rhodes. I've just put them back in the manila envelope. There's a bub behind Captain Rhodes, Rob. The good thing is that you can't accuse us of being sponsored because nobody would want to sponsor this. So it really is the ultimate get up. Duncan asks Steve, how's Winston been?
Duncan asks Steve. I did not ask Steve anything.
You know what I mean. Steve's asking, how's Winston been with the baby?
Oh, good, thank you. Yeah, very good. Very good. Bless him. Yeah, he sort of stands a guy. If we leave the room, you tend to come back and find him sat next to her, just sort of standing guard, really. He's very sweet.
Yeah,
he's
intensely adorable.
Yeah, he is. I have some very, very sweet pictures on my phone of him just sort of lying next to her.
I have some sweet pictures of Winston as well. I was just going through my camera roll last night for reasons best known to me. I can't remember why. And there's a few. I snapped a few of him when I was manky legged. He used to come and sit with me.
Yeah.
He used to come up and give my face a good old lick and give me a cuddle. Bless him. Oh, see, I am Snorlax redressing the balance. He's asking how Aslan's doing.
Aslan's all right. Someone's been letting off bloody fireworks tonight. So of course both animals bolt upright and then shat themselves. Obviously we have to then keep Aslan in because if he has the ability to leap fences, whereas Winston doesn't. So that's annoying. And we're into that season now where you have to keep the animals in. I don't know what it is. I think I get to a certain age where I'm just like, fireworks just really dick me off. Like I went out to the door because we have a dryer. Our dryer is outside in the shed, for those of you who don't know. And I went out and it's one of those things where it's like some neighbor not far away just let off a firework and it was like, it just went bang behind me and I was like, for fuck's sake. And it was like, and that was it. No more. There's just one firework. It's like, is that all? Did your budget not stretch to two?
Budget stretched to one.
Like, what the fuck was that? Like, just
my nostalgia for fireworks is mostly irresponsibly playing with them.
Yeah, well, I got November hit by a firework when I was, younger, and I had some mates who basically, it's the day I quote the day I nearly died, but that's a bit dramatic. But basically, I'd been up flying. So my friend from school's mum was a pilot, a display pilot. They have a Spitfire, and for my 21st birthday, she took me up, and they had a biplane, this like 40s biplane called a Stomp. It was a German biplane, and we did loops and we did barrel rolls and half Cubans, which were kind of fun, and it was awesome. And then we got back and they had a bonfire and fireworks, but the fireworks were just thrown into the bonfire. Like basically my mate thought it would be really funny to just take the fireworks and lob them into the bonfire, and we'd used my car to set up the bonfire because it was dark, so we used the headlights of my car, so my car was pointed at said bonfire. I was stood next to it. And it was a Ford Focus ZTEC, and an errant firework like a rocket came out the bonfire, literally came across it. You know when something's headed straight for you, it just went bounced off the ground a bunch of times, hit me in the chest, bounced off me, and hit my car and blew up the headlight.
Yeah,
and I was stood about a meter away from the car, so I figured that like basically if we'd been a meter back, it would have blown up on me. And it blew up. I couldn't hear anything for ages. I was freaking deafened by it. I was like, I was fuming at my mate, basically. I was like, that fucking edge, I fucking fired. that was bad times. But like, so I feel like kind of I got away with it. And I never became one of those like poster childs that we used to see an awful lot of.
Oh, dude, yeah.
The scalded child's hand.
Remember to put any fireworks that don't detonate into a bucket of cold water
or sand. Like, you know, it was just like a bucket of sand. Yes. Lying around, you know, is that sort of.
Yeah.
thing. That was it. Was that and chip pan fires. We were like that. Was, chip that, pan that fires. Was the COVID of our day, I think.
It truly was. So chip pan fires and because one of my a girl I went to school with, her uncle and the whole family, we kept it a chip pan fire. Chip pan fires like a fucking. Well, I'm glad you find it funny, Duncan.
I don't find it funny. I was just like, Jesus Christ. The whole family.
Her uncle, her auntie.
It's just not a thing that happens anymore, maybe because of that.
No, because of awareness, I suppose. Her uncle, her auntie, and both her cousins were killed in a chip pan fire. Shit. It's unreal, isn't it? It's unreal. It's crazy, the fact that that used to happen. So I watched don't want to segue something too, go light.
Was her white whale.
I did actually write a script with a joke about chip pan fires in it, yesterday. I watched a thing, I love old public information films, right? I just think they're this mad little treasure trove of stuff. And particularly kind of contemporary anxieties. And there's one in the 1970s, which is Don't Polish Your Floor Too Much. And it's it's a man and a woman with their wee babby walking into the house. And their mum has polished the floor too much, and the guy slips on the rug and falls on his back, and it goes, and they just got back from the hospital. Don't polish your floor too much, or whatever the fucking message was. And it's like, wow. So that was, sandwiched between.
Dun dun. Dun dun. The blood's coming out.
Yeah, the Bernard Herrmann.
Yes, yeah.
And we did just super chat there. Captain Meets Adventures, Walken does Rhodes. But Duncan doesn't know any Captain Rhodes dialogue. If you were to say, I'm running this monkey farm now, Frankenstein, in a Walken voice, this is like Scene of Evil, Ear No Evil.
What? I'm running this monkey farm.
I'm running this monkey farm now, Frankenstein, in a Walken voice.
I'm running this farm now. No, what is it? Monkey Boy.
Monkey Farm. Monkey Farm. See, Dunk has only seen Day of the Dead once, and it was just the sound off.
Yes. I'm running this monkey farm now. Frankenstein. What is it? I don't know.
That was the line. That was, because the mighty Joe Pilato, I'm going to put this away from myself. Because he kind of, it's insane. He does this I'm running this monkey farm now, Frankenstein, and I want to know what the fuck you do. And it's like the veins popping on it. Like it's the most unhinged performance, and it's amazing. Yeah, it's so, so good. And I don't really know how anyone else could do it, to be honest. I don't know.
Well, and clearly not Walker, and it doesn't sound like from tonight.
This monkey farm, Frankenstein.
Yeah. I'm running this farm now, monkey boy, whatever.
Because I quite like that
whoever
version.
You are.
Whatever your name is.
Something about zombies, I don't know.
I'm doing this stuff now, whatever your name is. In this place. With you people or whatever.
I hear there's zombies, but I don't care.
Yeah. See, I quite like his weird, scary, chilled out energy in that role.
Right.
As a kind of, because if you're going to recast Captain Rhodes, go the complete other direction and just, go. Because Joe Pilato just goes fucking bananas. It's so good.
Mm.
I should probably watch that again. I've only watched that twice this year. I should probably watch that again.
My wife does not understand how I can watch movies over and over again. She doesn't get it.
Something I've had to sell in some relationships and not others is that the idea of going to the cinema to see a thing you've already seen, particularly an old thing. And it's like, yeah, but it's the communal experience and it's the big screen. It's not even about the technical stuff. It's about seeing it in a room. And it's like, yeah, but you've already seen it. You got a DVD. It's like, but no, that's not the point. Not always. It's the reason I say, because it tends to be relationships, because that's when that's a crunch, isn't it? Because it's like you don't just do that with just anybody. You tend to do it with your partner. And it's kind of like, yeah, I want to go see the odd thing.
My response to all that is always, why do you own any DVDs then? Why do you own any films? It's like, if the whole thing is like, well, you just watch it once and then it's seared into your brain for the rest of your life. It's like, that's not the point. The point is that they move you and they make you feel things.
Yeah, exactly. Well, that's... My view on that is to take them to see something they love in a room of people that also love it. And that probably sell it on that. I remember my ex-girlfriend was all about, because she was well into that, which was lovely. And I was always a little bit skeptical of Jurassic Park as an adult. And when the Universal re-releases came out, I went to see The Thing. She wasn't so bothered about The Thing. But she was like, oh, yeah, please come see Jurassic Park with me. And I was kind of like, yeah, cool. And then seeing Jurassic Park on the big screen, I was kind of like, you know what? Like, I'm not in love with this film, but it is amazing. Like, it's a masterclass of building tension. Like, it's a really brilliantly crafted film in a way. And you just have to watch the second one to know how hard that is to do, because the second one is this big, flabby sort of mess. Whereas the first one is just this really tightly wound, very brilliantly executed piece of kind of spectacle cinema. And she was all kind of, because she loved Jurassic Park, she's like, oh, come see Jurassic Park with us, because she's going with her brother. And I was like, yeah, go on then. Sort of like in a kind of like, yeah, whatever way. But then I watched it, I was kind of like, oh, this is fucking great. What was I thinking?
Rob Myers asked us, he says, I'm attempting a gaming stream on Halloween where I'll be puppeting an animatronic skeleton. Could I get you to retweet the link when I get it set up? Yeah, of course, man.
Yeah, of course, man. I'm kind of off Twitter at the moment. I just went on to retrieve Dan's picture, but Ellie Mans are social. But yes, Rob, I'll come on Twitter on Saturday night just to retweet that, because that's amazing, and have a little watch.
Yeah, because you tag us both in it, we should see it. I'll try and get it on my personal one as well. So I don't have loads of followers. I think about, like, I don't know, how many have I got? Over 1,000. I've got 1,000 something.
Mine has, my Twitter following has been in this complete stasis ever since when we were on Ollie's side, like with a bigger audience. It used to just sort of slowly build, and I think what happens is I get new follows every day, but I think I also get new unfollows every day. So it's been in this kind of stasis. It's really weird. It's hung at around 1300, I guess, for like 2 years.
Yeah, I've got 1374.
Oh, look at that. Where's my fucking profile? Yeah. Yeah, see, how many got? Like, in 74, I've got 1,303. People just keep joining, seeing what I say and leaving.
I don't say anything on Twitter, though. I rarely use it, honestly. It's same with Instagram, but I seem to accrue things.
I put whimsical things on there. I'm afraid of saying anything most of the time.
Me too,
because if you sort of go like, I like puppies, it's kind of like, how dare you? Do you know how many puppies starve every year? I don't always say innocuous things, and I make rods for my own back, and that's silly. But it's when you say something completely innocuous, and someone who doesn't even follow you just emerges and tells you what an awful piece of shit you are.
Yeah,
it's just like, okay, you scary fuck.
It also just seems like a track record for, like, basically anyone in the future. If you ever attain any kind of notoriety whatsoever, someone's going to go back through it and find shit on you.
Oh yeah, that's how you get cancelled, isn't it? Yeah,
that's really. That's why I just don't engage in all that shit. You know, really, I don't think I might have done when I. The problem is, you know, you get into a point now where it's like 10, 12 years ago, when I was, you know, someone in my mid 20s, did I say something silly and, you know, pig-headed whatever I would have said, you know? But, you know, that you're gonna then be hauled over the coals. It's like, wow, obviously you don't like black people. It's like, excuse me, like, what? Like, what did I? You said a thing about a thing. It's like, well, you know, it's like what happened, you know, poor Kevin Hart and stuff like that. I know he made a.
It's a mixed bag, isn't it? Because some people just say something completely reprehensible and they deserve it. Other people say a joke and people deliberately misunderstand it.
Yeah.
Or other people say something completely innocuous. It's interpreted as the most. Like, and it's like, yeah, but you meant this. And it's like, they were tweeting about chocolate bars or something. Like,
I know, it's the impugning of motive that I find, really. It's like, look, what is this court? You know, if you let the court of public opinion run away with itself like that, I think it's, but, you know, that's what social media, we are the chimp with the hand grenade. It's like, social media is this thing that we just don't have the brains to comprehend. That's the problem. We don't have the brain that, like, says, when you say a thing, the whole world can see it. That's never happened to anyone in the history of humanity, and yet we have that at our fingertips. It really is, like,
I think that's the insanity of Twitter as well.
Yeah,
in that, because Facebook, generally speaking, you have to be someone's friend. You can search at someone's profile if it's public, but you won't be served things from it unless you follow them or whatever. Whereas, like, on Twitter, you are just putting it out there for fucking everybody, and it's kind of usually a bad thing. I'm not gonna lie, it's quite often a bad thing. But, you know, I just had to fucking do it. It just stresses me out. It's just this horribly toxic place, isn't it?
Yeah,
I hate when I'm just sort of innocuously scrolling through and I see people arguing, and before I know it, I've started clicking on the replies to read what they're arguing about. Why are you doing that?
I know. It's like, is someone saying what I want to say?
Like, yes.
Leave it.
Leave it.
Yeah, I know. It's so bad. That's the thing, but it is that sort of thought chain, I guess, that you're kind of following, and it's like, it's dangerous. It's really bad. It's bad shit, man.
It's a bad time.
Actually, no, I won't say that. I'm not going to say that because it's about my wife and it's personal. I'm not going to do it.
My wife. Right.
Well, my wife, I put it this way. My wife was on TV at one point through her job and was kind of trending sort of a little bit.
Duncan's wife is Amanda Holden. That's the secret that he's been keeping this whole time.
Sure, why not?
Amanda Holden.
You could have picked a better, like that. Really? You went to Amanda Holden.
That's just what came in my head.
She's like 15 years older than me. I did do better.
Peak Amanda Holden was so sexy, right? Now, she totally was. Like, no, fuck that. Go back to peak Amanda Holden of the 90s. She was really hot. Now she looks like a haunted statue of herself because she says so much Botox. And that's not
very
nice.
A bit like Gina Davis.
Yeah, I know. So much filler. Have you seen Madonna recently? Jesus Christ.
Fine. No one wants to see
her. I don't even have a readily available joke for that. It's like someone tried to play all of the cast of Cats, but only had blue tack. Okay, so maybe I do have a readily available joke for that.
Oh, Christ.
I had one of my friends I caught up with recently. He told me there's some podcast that's a kind of comedy podcast where you have to pick your fantasy meal. So you have to choose a three course meal and you can have whatever you want and da da da. And ours got so out of control that mine ended up that I would have, because it was magic, I would have an infinite stomach, and then for the first course, it would be the best Papa Doms in the world with all the dips, and then the second course would be the entire McDonald's menu except for the fish ones, and then for the third course, I said that I wanted to have the ice cream platter with the sparklers in that I had at a restaurant in Cambridge called Sweeney Todd's when I was 5, and he said, that's fine, but your parents have to be there and they have to be proportionally the size they were to you when you were 5, so they're 12 foot tall, and also I agreed that my date would be Kelly Brook.
Watching you eat McDonald's endlessly.
Well, she would have some as well. And because I could choose the venue, it was in a Laser Quest as well.
That's wrong. You should have said Megatron.
I don't want to do it in Megatron. I want to do it in Laser Quest.
Megatron was Laser Quest. Megatron turned into a McDonald's.
Without any laser questing in it.
Yeah. The I remember Sweeney Todd's. It's now a... Yeah,
it was a Bella Italia, and then
now
it's something else.
Some other chain.
It's got a kind of milling wheel in it.
Yeah, it's an old mill. So it's got you've got tables that have glass inserts in them, and you can look down.
See it churning.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Someone's making noises on Twitch, and I don't know what they're doing, so I'm not paying attention to Twitch. I'm very sorry if you did a nice thing. Thank you.
if you did a bad thing. You as well.
Probably also thank you. That probably counts to some kind of algorithm. I don't know. Thanks. Try not to do bad things. Kind of neglected. You've reached 1,000 messages today with Restream chat, so maybe that's what that was. It wasn't Twitch, it was Restream celebrating on our behalf. Someone gave I am sorry to say someone gave us bits on Twitch, which is how you make money on Twitch.
Oh, thank you, whoever did that.
I'm so sorry, whoever did that. We're just hopeless with Twitch. I've just tried, and I just feel I'm just too old to get it, and I don't know what's going on.
Just checking the PayPal. Sorry, Annalise Moschlin sent us $5.
Cheers, Annalise.
Thank you. And she says, hi, guys. Sorry to say Michael and I can't watch live this week, but looking forward to watching tomorrow. That's very sweet.
It's a silly one. When you catch up, if you're watching this part in the future, it was quite a fun, silly one. The film's over, you've probably realised there wasn't a lot of Halloween talk in it. more about kind of donkeys with Phillips or cross-nose screwdrivers for hooves.
And someone's willy. Stuff.
someone's willy padlocked to a dog that's chasing a car full of sausages. And what I imagine Saw to be. Yeah, just to recap. That's what I imagine Saw to be. But I can't be certain, frankly.
Tobin Bell tying a man's willy to... The thing is that those...
man's willy!
A man's willy. Or a woman's willy. What that film series sort of like it relies on is you kind of being put in their shoes, but what you don't see is the planning phase and the execution phase where Tobin Bell like ties the willy to a string and has to find the dog and then get the sausages ready. Like, he has to cook
Danny
them.
Glover's willy, probably.
You know,
it's the same as Michael Myers hopping over the fence and having to sprint.
Yeah,
it's the same thing. All the elaborate
because it's behind the curtain.
The Rube Goldberg-esque mousetrap. So believe in the Saw continuity. So he dies.
Yeah.
But then it turns out he's made an apprentice that's doing it all for him.
Yeah.
And that kind of, I'm not going to try and recant this sort of little rant I did about, you know, continuity and Saw. But then, and because there's got to be like this insanely elaborate warehouse full of dogs and sausages and padlocks.
And pulleys. A lot of pulleys.
He's got a wholesale agreement with a local retailer.
He pays cash. He doesn't ask questions. He knew his dad.
Been coming here for years. He has. Oh yeah, more padlocks, is it? Pet shop next door.
Padlocks, pulleys, and bear traps. That's what he's after.
Butchers after that to get the sausages. They're supposed to be rebooting Saw again.
If you don't answer the question, it sounds like Liam Neeson. If you don't answer the question, no, the bear trap will eat your willy. But if you admit now that you sold a baby broken glass, then
that'll be whatever. £5, please. Flashback to a baby with an enormous fiver.
With both hands.
You sold a baby broken glass. You sold a baby broken glass. So I put you in a window with a bear trap on your wallet.
Attached to a dog and a sausage truck is about to go past the women. You know, is that
also the dog's on roller skates to make it faster.
Being unless chased you by a donkey with needle nose pliers for a penis and Phillips head screwdrivers for hoes.
Unless you can open this tin of dog offal with just your hands, the dog will chase the sausage lorry and the and the donkey will unscrew your kneecaps. I'm the commuter.
I have a particular set of skills.
No, I have a particular set of saws. That's my pitch for the whatever the Saw reboot's called. Liam Neeson plays Saw. John Saw. And he lives in a...
No, Cole Saw. That's... Because Cole is a name, right, in America. So Cole
Saw. Yeah, Cole Saw. Cole Saw. And he lives in a big warehouse next to a pet shop, a wholesale hardware shop.
He wants revenge on the world for his name. And
for
so,
his name. So he goes, and that's derived from the Scandinavian word for one who sells broken glass to babies. And in the Saw universe of the reboot, the whole logic of it hinges on the fact that babies have immense buying power. They've just got loads of disposable income.
Because we went from the teenagers, right? So that's how, you know, like in the 60s and the mods and the rockets, everyone, like the teenagers became had buying power. So now it's babies. That's the logical.
There's a baby driving around. There's a baby driving around in a Cadillac with his best girl. and then Cole Saw comes out. Goes, would you like to buy some broken glass? And the babies don't know what that is. And babies instinct to put things in their
they
mouth.
Just buy everything. They
just buy everything. Oh no, sorry, not Cole Saw.
Not
the man. The greedy, avaricious broken glass salesman sells it. Broken glass. Get your broken glass. you better not be selling that to babies. He put things. No, I'd never do that. And then he sells it to Friday night. And then Cole Saw tricks him. He tricks him by putting on a Broken Glass Expo and sending him a VIP ticket. Yeah. And the man turns up to the Broken Glass Expo. And before he could do anything, the clamp goes on, the padlock goes on his willy. And then Cole Saw, played by Liam Neeson, comes on his tiny little tricycle and drags him by the padlock and then sets up, just clips him on and goes, this Dutchend is going to chase that. Dutchend on roller skates is going to chase that sausage lorry.
Finn. Credit.
Eddie Murphy reprises the role of Donkey.
Is that a sausage lorry? Donkey. Does anyone need any auto repairs?
Look, I mean,
it writes itself. I mean,
it does write itself, and I'm sick to death of these. But they just go. You know what?
It may as well be that, though. I mean, at this point.
They make these bland reboots by committee, and no one wants to just hire a couple of sexy renegades like us to come and rescue Liam Neeson's career. I'm sure he'd be down for it, you know? And I would do, I think, in the wake of COVID, to boost the economy of our area, I would insist that they were Newmarket sausages.
Right. Yes. Not
and
Cumberland.
Then they would not Cumberland. No. Fuck the North. And they would buy. It's all about East England. They'd buy them in bulk and use actual Cumberland sausages. I think also I would insist upon using kind of orphan starving dogs.
Right.
So they get to eat sausages and or willies, in order to nourish them. Use real local babies.
Real local babies.
It's really important to me that the Saw reboot has a low carbon footprint. I make Liam Neeson take a boat here. Is that better or worse?
With Greta
Thunberg. Yeah, and they can stop and, you know,
come down an estuary somewhere.
They can stop and read poetry to a whale somewhere. Just to cancel out all the tires.
I wonder, lonely as a cloud. And that's the end of global warming. Thank you, Liam. And
thanks, Liam. Oh, I mean, I have seen the first Saw film and a bit of the one that's got Marky Mark's brother in it, or that lad from New Kids on the Block or whatever. I don't need to see the other nine or whatever. I reckon you and I have just nailed that.
I think so.
And it goes a neat, very neat little Halloween package that does, full of Newmarket sausages.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think so.
I think once that money has gone back into Newmarket, they could probably reopen their Wimpy.
they could get rid of the what's the shitty, what is it called, Nicer or whatever, that store. That like grocery shop that only Netto's. They have a Netto.
Oh, they got a Netto there, are they?
Yeah. So there's
a Nicer or a Nicer up around Cherrington Way. Yeah. We don't have a Netto up here. I think that's a thing in Viz, like an area with like a rundown area with a Netto in Roger Bafanasaurus is called a Netto Ghetto.
Yep. Sounds all right.
Oh, fucking hell. Well, I'm, you know, I've been, such is the malaise, the melancholy of COVID, that I've been marginally excited to go to Aldi. Something to do, innit?
Yeah.
Something to do. It's like go and play pool with my mate the other night. Just that'll be board games next. I don't understand board games. I get confused by board games. It takes a big man to admit that. Board games, team sports, and large supermarkets are like kryptonite to me. It just absolutely twists my melon. I just don't know what to do with it.
Can you hear what sounds like a little bird?
Is it a Dachshund chasing a sausage lorry?
Yeah, no. If you heard anything there, that if that sounded like someone going through a small quarry, That was Aslan
going through a
having at the poo cave next door. He little bastard. He should have been let out.
Having at the poo cave.
The problem is, right, he has a poo cave that's currently in our bathroom, which is next to me right here in our spare room. And if he doesn't get let out, well, he shouldn't go in there. It's annoying because you don't want to let him in there for pooing and weeing. Really, it should be a last resort. But he doesn't have a cat flap, so you kind of understand it. But like, he does it at like 3 a.m. He'll be in there like he's digging for gold. And it's just like, would you get on with it? Take your 3 a.m. shit, for fuck's sake.
That's the thing with cats, man, because I love cats, but I like that part of living with cats. It's been a long time since I lived with a very long time since I lived with a cat. Hey, cats. But it is just a sort of like 4 a.m. Open the door and they just sort of go, I just leave. I just wanted proof of life, like a kidnapping.
The problem is, we used to lock. He is literally the little destructive shit. Before him, he predates me in my wife's chronology. But she used to be one of those who let him sleep on the bed. I turn up, Mr. Light Sleeper, can't have anything around me. Like he is a big cat. And he will climb on you and
can confirm.
And so I was like, get him the fuck out. I can't sleep with him in here. Like, because he literally wants to lie between your legs and I don't want to move around. And he's like this seriously heavy cat that just wants, and it's just like, get him out of here. So I got him out of here. But then that was a rod for my own back because he would sit on the landing and shout at me and wake me up. So that was a.
Oi! Wake up!
Fucker! So then he got shot in the living room, but then we got a nice new sofa that he then started ripping apart out of protest. So then he had to come out of the living room, which meant he could then free roam the house again because because then we got Winston and we couldn't shut him in the kitchen because if we shut him in the kitchen, we have to put the poo cave in there and Winston goes in the poo cave and eats the poo. So we couldn't have that. So that means that now he free roams the house and shouts at me at 5 a.m. Bloody morning. But it's okay because my daughter's shouting at me right about then anyway.
So don't let him in, he'll eat the shit. Just standard dog behavior.
Fuck's sake.
Normal dogging around, eating some it's shit.
Like, what are they? They're the man's best friend, but they do like to eat shit. It's like, why?
And then give you a big, lovely kiss.
It's like, leave it out.
I may have told this before. I think this is probably something I've told multiple times across multiple channels. But I say it anyway because it's a great memory. My neighbour when I was growing up had a dog, like a collie called Gypsy. Not particularly correct anymore, but it was the late 80s. And I remember that she once, there's like a kind of lay-by outside my mum and dad's old house, like a big bit of green. And I watched this dog. She must have had like some dicky tummy. She went out and did about 3 or 4 shits on the thing.
Oh, no.
But perhaps waiting for them to cool, she did them all. And once she completed the circuit, she went and ate them in the order she laid them.
Oh, no.
And it's like, I don't like them too warm. I like it. She's got sensitive teeth or something.
Like Winston doesn't eat his own. He's not. Like,
oh, that. Good. Yeah, fine, he's not a monster.
But he finds it like when you're out. I mean, he doesn't do it as much with me anymore because I'm quite stern with him over that, but yeah, he does it with my wife sometimes, and so she muzzles him now when they go out, especially now because it's darker. So they go out, and the amount of time she comes back and it's like the muzzle's got a load of shit on the end of it. It's like, it doesn't matter what you do with animals, you're going to pay the price one way or another. And the price is shit. It's basically shit. That's it. Like, it's just
To reference Roger's Profanosaurus again from Viz, for it is one of my favourite things, one of the entries was Gorilla's Breakfast, and a Gorilla's Breakfast was a shit that smells so good you want to turn around and eat it back out of the pan.
Out of the pan?
Smells so good you eat it, yeah.
Right.
And I once saw, I think it was a Reddit thread about people who are into coprophagy, which is the fancy word for eating poo. And
sounds like
in case
copper.
You're wondering. It's for the copper. I really like it. It's my favourite reactive metal. They were going like, oh no, it just tastes like what was eaten. I bet it doesn't though. I bet it tastes like shit. I've got a feeling it probably like tastes like shit.
And shit.
Yeah, exactly. But, I mean, it is ultimately still shit. Oh, look, it's just having that steak again. No, it isn't. There's a rule of, you know, there's definitely the like a rule of entropy. Yeah, exactly. You can't have that, this kind of nutritional perpetual motion machine where you just eat one bit of Kobe beef and then continue to shit it out and eat it for all of time. Well, that's not how that works.
Apparently in dogs, it's like... if they eat their own, it's behavioral. It's because they feel bad. It's like they've been badly trained, toilet trained. So it's like they're eating it to get rid of it. But with most dogs that do it, it's because they eat other animals' shit. They don't eat their own because their own doesn't smell nice to them. But the other animals, they can smell the nutrition that they can get from it. This is what happens when you have a very good sense of smell, because you can smell, you can identify things in something that will help you. But it's like, yes, but it's also shit, Winston. And there's probably a load of stuff in there you ought not to eat. Like a fox taking a dump is not like, I mean, what the fuck? Like,
and the best part about that is that dogs who have the luxury of wet food are eating kind of foul, awful.
Yeah.
And it's like, ooh, I can smell foul, awful. but in poo form.
Have you ever tried a dog biscuit? Have you ever tried eating it?
I didn't want to know where that was going. Have you ever tried dog shit? No, I think I had. I did it as a dare, I think, because my ex, we did that as a dare.
Yeah.
And it was kind of, it just tasted sort of plain and a bit.
Like, yeah, just really plain and sort of greasy for some reason. The same with cat biscuits, very greasy, sort of plain. I tried a Dreamies once. That was horrible.
That's quite an intense burst of... cat pleasing flavor as
apparently,
well,
yeah, but it's horrible. Like, it's all very bland stuff, but they don't like, if I watch Winston eat, he takes no pleasure in it. He barely chews any. I had to buy him a bowl that had loads of, it was like a sort of maze that he can't just guzzle.
I take no pleasure in it. No,
he said as he, no, but it's like it takes him ages to eat it, because it's like because before he was just guzzling it. And I put my hand on his throat one time and I could feel clumps of just dry biscuit going glug glug, like you couldn't hear chewing. He just swallowed whole biscuits.
They are astonishing creatures for that. I mean, it's just kind of like, yeah, they are. Because really, as you found out on the hard end of that, it's just kind of like they will eat things that make them die, and not sort of like, oh, I wonder if this mushroom's poisonous. It's kind of like, oh, good, a razor blade.
It's not. Like, I wonder if this mushroom is poisonous. It's, I wonder if this mushroom was poisonous.
Yes.
Because too
and
late,
also
I ate it.
It was wrapped in broken glass and cyanide.
Sold to me by the man over there, the aberrations, broken glass salesman. But it's okay, because Cole Saw
is here. Don't worry, little doggy. I'm going to get you to chase a sausage
protector of babies and dogs.
Noble protector of
but
babies and
kind
dogs.
Kind of reactive rather than proactive. But there you are. That's it.
And not dogs that sell broken glass to other babies.
I don't like dogs that eat their own shit, because that's behavioral. But if you eat another man's shit, I will find you.
I will find you, and I will applaud you. Particular set of padlocks. I'm all for this. I think we should just bin all this off and just do the Saw remake.
Hey, why not?
Imagine getting sued by Universal for making an unauthorized Saw film with Liam Neeson. let me just, what's going on? Okay, we're in the last 10-ish minutes.
The death throes.
Just breathe a little. Just breathe a little bit. Just need to let the air flow after that.
There's a comment here that I sort of almost don't want to know what it's in reference to, so I'm gonna enjoy it out of context. But soda drinking or drinking corridor janitor says to Steve Allen, her stream of brown glitter made her look like she had a magical ass. Just gonna leave that.
Stream of brown glitter.
Each one of those words, by the way, was punctuated by what I can only assume was the ringing from the springs on your mic's arm. Because it kind of went bang, bang.
I'm going to get my foot off my wee table. Because everybody in the stream would have heard that as well. Yeah. They'd have heard that as well. I'd put something on
if
my
you,
wallet.
If you tap your mic, I will find you. And
that's the thing with this. With the road mic... I could do what I like. I could roughhouse it, but this mic picks up all things. My pop shield's on the piss, so
I must get a pop shield. Well, I'm going to get, I need to say, I'm going to get Rode Mike and a pop shield. So hopefully, I might even have it by the next stream, which would be nice.
We got to get your camera and light sorted, and then we'll be laughing.
Yeah. Yes, I have a voiceover job coming up that I need it for as well. I'm going to do that.
Well, there you go. Yeah. There you go.
There you go.
I've made a. I've bodged a motorized slider and a gimbal together and made a sort of motion control rig that I'm going to go and use. I think I'll get a motion control time lapse, but then I can also, when I'm self-taping, I can have camera moving. It's kind of neat. Huh? I can get those kind of moving, sweeping movements.
That'd be cool.
That should be quite cool. No, it's quite fun. It's something to do just to get out. I did some work. I did some camera up last week, and I've been doing, I was, like I said before the stream, I had a client. I was sending something to a client in the when the countdown was on for the viewing public. I was still sending stuff to this client because it has to go to a third, you know, it's like a house buying chain. Mm-hmm. I had to send it on to a web developer and then it's do a thing. It's kind of like, oh fuck, like I'm sat here dressed as a horror film character trying to do that. So yeah, We need to sort of get back in the room again soon, don't we, I suppose?
Yeah, I know. I would love to resume normal. I mean, we have talked about the revamp and trying to come back with bigger production values and stuff. And I think we will.
We will. It's just when. That's the issue, isn't it? I mean, these streams are doing nicely. I've written at least one more review. What I'd really like is us to go out together and film something else in the vein of the Night of the Living Dead thing.
Sure.
That would be good. But it's too much risk at the moment. We're in the middle of a second fucking wave. We have to wait for that to go before we think about that, I suppose.
Yeah.
News.
Yeah, man. Yeah. There was talk, and I'm kind of leaving this up to you, but there was talk of taking next week off because someone asked what plans are for after this month.
I would quite like it. I need a week off. Please, everyone.
Yeah.
I don't want to sound pathetic. Please. But yeah, I've got obligation. We may do a gaming stream this weekend, but I'm taking some time away. Mm-hmm. So I think probably no stream next week, maybe the week after, but no, I would definitely come back after that. But I think maybe no stream for 1 week, definitely no stream for 2 weeks, maybe, I would say.
Okay.
But I reckon week off next week for me, please, thanks, bye.
Italy,
I just need to chill out a little bit.
Yeah.
So sorry about that, but
no.
Might get I want to try and get this review knocked out and then just fuck off for a bit. I've still got work. I've still got a little bit of work on. Got one job on. If someone fucking calls me and says, come and do work, well, I just have to, don't I? Because I'm not on a salary, so I just have to fucking do it. I have to do it. I have to go where I'm needed. Like a banana man, I guess.
I'll do something in your absence. To, you know, babies and coprophagy dogs. Notwithstanding, I think if I can, I will try and do something maybe for Patreon, just to keep that up, because I you know, I'm always painfully aware that I realize as well, like, a lot of what we are supposed to deliver to Patreon we can't at the moment, so I kind of want to keep, and you've been very good at this as well, kind of trying to keep up with delivering them content. So I think
yes, we're up to date with the watch party. Mm-hmm. That happened, and I put a little video about how to make your room look like the inside of Prince's brain today. So,
well, black and full of worms
in a box. Oh, tasteful Prince humor.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I need a break.
Yeah,
I'm just tired. I need a break. And then we'll come back. But we really want to just bring our shows back and be normal again and do some commentaries and all that. And we just want to have a revamp as well. There will be a revamp.
It'd be nice to be in the same room again, you know? It's like...
It really would. Yeah. Fucking people talk about fucking Highlander, man. Someone came at me on the gaming stream. Someone came at me on the gaming stream and was kind of like, how can you not like Highlander and like Freddy versus Jason? And I was like, fuck you, man. Freddy versus Jason slaps. Highlander can eat one. Or worse to that effect. Highlander is shit.
Yeah.
So make points. I would look down the lens when I say Highlander is shit, because I just do it for emphasis.
Fair enough. Neil Hutchinson says a new episode of Driving with Duncan. I don't have a car, mate, at the moment. So I can't.
You could sit in a chair and hold a dinner plate or a hoop.
I mean, we have a car, so we still have my wife's car, but I don't. I don't have one. Although I'm going to get one. I just don't. There's not been any need yet. It's one of those like, well, I'm not going anywhere, so to go to the expense of either buying one outright or getting one on finance, there's just no point, because it's like I'm not going anywhere. There's nothing to do. I mean, on the other occasion where we need to move us, baby, and dog, then yes. But I mean, that's not really happening. So buggy pushing with Duncan, yeah, maybe. I don't need to walk with the buggy though. It's a pain in the ass. I'd put her in the caboo and walk around.
Oh, is that the thing on your front?
Yeah,
carrier.
Yeah, it's one carrier. Of those stupid
put a camera
words.
On the baby.
Yeah, it's like Philips. It's a brand. It's, not...
it's a brand. It's cross nose. yeah, maybe gaming stream this week. Ivan and I, when I do come back, Ivan and I will probably do a retro gaming stream. Now the theme streams are over for a bit.
Hmm.
I imagine we'll probably do something Christmas themed, run up to Christmas, will we?
Yeah.
So like we'll do Christmas stuff, but Ivan and I will talk about doing a retro game stream, because quite often the gaming streams is like Ivan mans the chat and we just talk and I play the game. It's a retro stream. We can be a bit more democratic and he can have a go on the, because he doesn't really play modern games particularly.
Fair enough.
So you know,
that'll be good. Adrian Mendoza asked me what would be my dream car. I just very vicariously, I've been very fortunate to have a friend in particular who has owned several supercars and taken me with him, or he's a member of supercar club, and it's quite a big one, and the events have gotten bigger and bigger over the years, and so we've seen some, been very privileged to see some incredible cars and very rare cars and very special cars, including the only road legal Ferrari FXX in the world, and a fully restored Aston Martin DB5, which is James Bond's car obviously, and all sorts of stuff. Anyway, I right now, it's quite modest. I would like, my favorite, so my friend's had a sort of eras of cars, but my favorite era of his was when he had an Aston Martin DBS and a Porsche 911 Carrera S. That's when he owned two. He had two, and he had his daily car as well, but those were his two like kind of special cars. And that was my favorite period. Those two weren't the most extravagant. He now has a McLaren, which I do like, but I'm kind of like, which is the one I had at the wedding. He drove me to in the way. I do like that car a lot. I respect it more than I like it. I think I really like that. The Aston wasn't the fastest. It wasn't the flashiest, but it was classy. It sounded amazing. And it was just, I know it was James Bond's car. I get that. Let's get that out of the way. But I do love it. And I got to drive the 911 a few times and I was like, I love that. I love that, having that, those two cars. Cause you had the sort of, the 911 was a cab. So it was like, you know, drop top. And I was like, that is my heaven. If I could have those two cars and then like have I'd have like an Audi RS6 or a BMW M5, you know, like a big exec estate as your everyday car. And then those two in my garage, I would be happy. An Aston of some kind. I mean, I would love the new Vantage. I actually quite like it. A lot of people don't like it. I would love one of those and a Porsche 911. And if I could just change them up every few years, that's my heaven. I don't want too much, Richard. I don't want too much. I'm not asking for a Bugatti or anything crazy like that.
I know all of those words.
But they mean nothing.
I was able to garner quite a lot from context.
Well, you know, the McLaren is the orange one.
Yes, that's one I've seen in the flesh.
Yes.
And not in the flesh, more so not in the flesh, I've seen it.
Mm.
On my computer screen. Mm. What does that mean?
Seen it in the metal.
That's what that means. It's metal. I delete it.
In the carbon fiber.
Right. Let's end this.
Kyber. Let's end it.
It's time to go. It's time to go. You've had your sausages. You've sold your broken glass. Now it's time to go. Right. Thanks, everyone. Tell you, boy. It's been a pleasure. It's been a fun Halloween. I've really enjoyed the dress-ups and the silly intro and the silly outro, and it's been fun.
Thank you for all your hard work. I really appreciate it. I don't, you know, Richard does all the behind the scenes stuff and he sets all this glorious stuff up. I just Skype or Zoom in and then
see. Yeah, but who else am I going to talk to about fucking Liam Neeson and sausage lorries?
Well, quite. I think Ivan's probably sick of it at this point.
Exactly, precisely. Yeah. Precisely. If anything, you give Ivan a holiday and that's a community service. All right. Dan Law says Mandalorian starts tomorrow. Interesting.
I don't have to anymore. But anyway.
Oh, no, do I actually? I might throw down a fiber just to watch that. Who's to say? Right, release at Halloween weekend. What the fuck? Credits.
Said the Disney execs.
Credit. Bye.